field following a cardiac arrest. The game was postponed and he's in critical condition. We'll talk about safety sports with NBC Sports Boston reporter and anchor Trini Casey. Later, we're joined by Gina McCarthy, the first ever White House climate advisor, on our climate emergency. It's all to come ahead. Boston Public Radio, 89.7 GBH.
Live from NPR News in Washington, I'm Corva Coleman. The new Congress comes to Capitol Hill today, and Republicans will control the House of Representatives. The first thing the House needs to do is choose a speaker, and Republican leader Kevin McCarthy appears to be just short of the votes to win. This election is vital. No other House business can happen until a speaker is elected, and it's not clear McCarthy can win on the first ballot. The NFL's Buffalo Bills have not released further information about the condition of player DeMar Hamlin. He collapsed during the football game last night against the Cincinnati Bengals. The Bills say CPR was performed and Hamlin's heartbeat restored before he was rushed to the hospital. He is sedated, in critical condition. The Hamlin family spokesman, Jordan Rooney, did not have an update when he spoke to ABC's Good Morning America.
I can't speak specifically on his medical condition. I will say is that, you know, he's fighting. He's a fighter.
The NFL postponed the Bills-Bengals game. No word on when it will be rescheduled. Rainy weather and flooding continue to cause problems in parts of California. From member station KCRW, Matt Gillum reports several more inches of rain are in the forecast.
The storms pummeling California left tens of thousands of people around Sacramento in the dark as the new year began and caused the Cosumnes River to flood. In the mountains near Lake Tahoe, some areas reported getting around 4 feet of snow. Forecasters say a system that will roll into Northern California Wednesday night will pack a powerful punch, bringing several more inches of rain to the region and gusting winds around 40 miles per hour. Meanwhile, Southern California is gearing up to get soaked as well. By Thursday, that same storm could bring up to 3 inches of rain to some valley areas around L.A. and up to 4 inches to the mountains. And more could be on the way. The National Weather Service says modeling shows the active and stormy pattern remaining in place into next week. For NPR News, I'm Matt Gillum.
An Israeli ultranationalist cabinet minister has visited a sensitive religious site for the first time since Israel's far-right government took office. This has drawn widespread protests from Arab countries and a response from the U.S. NPR's Daniel Estrin reports from Tel Aviv.
Under heavy guard, Israel's new national security minister, Itamar Ben-Gvir, toured Jerusalem's most sensitive site. The Al-Aqsa Mosque compound, a Muslim holy site, is also revered in Jewish tradition. Cabinet Minister Ben-Gvir wants Jewish ultranationalist activists to have expanded access and even prayer rights. The Palestinian Authority protested. So did Israel's Arab allies Jordan, Egypt, and the United Arab Emirates. The U.S. Embassy in Jerusalem says actions that don't preserve the status quo are, quote, unacceptable. Since the start of the new year, Israeli troops have killed at least 3 Palestinians during clashes in the occupied West Bank, including 2 gunmen and a teenager. Daniel Estrin, NPR News, Tel Aviv.
On Wall Street, stocks are lower. The Dow is down about 6 points at 33,141. The Nasdaq is down 45 points. This is NPR.
Good morning. With the latest from the GBH newsroom, I'm Henry Santoro in Brookline today. The mystery headliner for Governor-elect Maura Healey's inaugural celebration is no longer a mystery, and it's none other than the immensely popular singer-songwriter Brandi Carlile.
Ooh, I follow my track, see all the times I should have turned back.
Carlile will perform at the TD Garden on Thursday night alongside a number of local performers to help Healey and Lieutenant Governor-elect Kim Driscoll kick off their new administration. Healey has said that she's been a Brandi Carlile fan for a long time, and along with Healey's announcement this morning, Carlile also released a statement saying in part that the victories of Healey and Driscoll were decades in the making, and we know that there's more work ahead, but now is the time to pause and celebrate this historic moment. A Washington State native, Carlile married her wife, Catherine Shepherd, in 2012 in Wareham. City and fire officials in Lynn are warning landlords about adhering to local zoning regulations after crews responding to emergency calls discovered multiple illegal apartments in recent weeks. The Lynn Item reports that Fire Chief Joseph Zuckus believes that a lack of affordable housing options is driving the creation of dangerous, unpermitted basement apartments and other dangerous and illegal living arrangements. Celtics in Oklahoma City tonight for a game against the Thunder. Tip-off is at 8. We're at 41 degrees in Boston right now. I'm Henry Santoro, GBH News 89.7.
I am Marjorie Egan. You're listening to Boston Public Radio 89.7 GBH. We are broadcasting for the first time in 2023 from the Boston Public Library. We're here every Tuesday and every Friday, and we are streaming live on youtube.com/GBH News. Happy New Year again, Jim.
And to you. Can you do me a small favor?
Thank you. Little applause from the audience here.
Very little applause. Can you don't touch anything, because everything
you
touch is
I knocked out the TV.
Has stopped working.
Well, we're going to fix it. We have engineers. We have engineers in here that know how to do this.
No, they're really fond of you.
I need an engineer to move into my house. That's what I need full time.
So is this three days? Yeah, 3 days into the year, we've shaken the proverbial magic eight ball, and the results are in, Marjorie. Outlook bleak.
Bleak.
We talk a lot about things based on surveys on the show, some more credible than others, but a new Gallup poll seems pretty legitimate and conclusive. Americans are overwhelmingly pessimistic about the new year. 90% of Americans expect political conflict in 2023. 8 in 10 expect economic struggles. We want to know, are you among them? And if you are, and you call or text in, we have one simple rule today. You have to also tell us one thing you have hope for or are optimistic about the new year. Not in your personal life, but in something that affects people beyond just you, at 877-301-8970. 72% think the crime rate will go up, 56% many strikes by labor unions, 85% of U.S. adults predict the year ahead will be fraught with international discord, on and on and on. Are you pessimistic about the year ahead?
Well, I'm not that pessimistic, but I am. I tell you what I'm optimistic about.
Oh, good. Let's do that.
Even though we're going to talk to Gina McCarthy, who, big EPA person nationally
and locally.
She was
head of the EPA for Obama.
Exactly.
Climate advisor to Joe Biden.
And even though there's that horrible piece we're going to talk to her about that was on 60 Minutes Sunday night, basically saying that the planet will survive, but we won't.
Sixth extinction is
coming
history
very
of the
soon.
Planet. That's right.
I do think it's finally dawning on people that we are in big trouble with the climate, and we just can't sit around and say, "Oh, it's too expensive not to get us to get a sewer system, or it's too expensive to do this," because everything is falling apart around us. So I think that's one good thing I'm optimistic
about.
Well,
I don't know if you know, the Republicans, as of today, have taken over the House of Representatives. Who among them are supportive of an aggressive
climate protection strategy? I don't think it's going to happen nationally. I think it's going to happen locally. I think we're going to talk with Gina McCarthy about this later. I think things are going to happen on Cape Cod because people have bought homes on polluted water and they're not going to stand for it, I hope.
But they say they can't afford the fixes. Did you read the story in the New York Times?
That was the town administrator from Mashpee who said they can't afford the fixes. Yeah. I think if you're sitting on top of a polluted lake, you realize that your house is worth nothing, and that's going to be a great motivation.
So here's someone who has a little optimism.
Yep.
Benjamin in Brighton texts, the country might be going to pot, but at least I'm optimistic we're about to see Kevin McCarthy crash and burn harder than anyone since Icarus. Happy New Year. By the way, we should know about that in the next hour or so.
What are you optimistic about, Mr. Browdy, over there?
I mean, honestly, mm-hmm. I think we have a great new batch, we'll see how they perform, of new leaders in the state. I mean, the state on virtually every level is run by women, mostly younger generation women.
I know, it's great.
All of whom come in with pretty good plans. Of course, Mayor Wu's been there for a while. Rachel Rollins has been there for a while. I think that's a really good direction for the state.
I think we are very lucky to be living in Massachusetts.
Can I tell you the other thing I'm optimistic about? And by the way, I said in the opening, I don't want just things that are personal to you, but I'm going to make an exception, my own rule. The thing I was optimistic about, I didn't realize until I got home last night, 12 of the 13 salamis you gave me are still in my refrigerator. So I figure, how much better can that be?
How long do they last, those salamis?
It's funny you should ask. I Googled that last night.
Do you have to freeze them?
May I answer your question?
Certainly.
You asked it, I should answer it.
Certainly answer it, Jim.
Okay, in the refrigerator, because they're hard salamis, they're between hard and soft salami. I checked that out too. 6 weeks in the fridge. You ready for this? Many months in the refreezer.
There you go.
So
you are all set.
I froze most of them and kept a few out.
I was distraught. It was supposed to be one a month, and things got goofed up with an extra one.
877-301-897. You know what the problem, though, is? I'm not a shrink, but when you enter a year with such pessimism about virtually every issue that will affect your life, as is suggested in this poll. I didn't even read you some of the categories. Virtually everyone is horrible. Don't you think it affects in a really negative way how you live your everyday life? Because it sort of trickles down into everything you do. Do you know what I mean? I mean, it's like this.
Well, Deborah from
cloud
Salem,
hanging over you.
Deborah from Salem is optimistic that 2023 will be Trump's annus horribilis. Is that how you pronounce it?
I know what you mean.
Horribilis, whatever it is. The great line from Queen Elizabeth when all her children were all over the tabloids. Her grandchildren as well. And the Windsor Castle had the fire and all that kind of stuff. She said that was her horrible year. I think it may be a horrible year for Donald Trump, but if you don't like President Trump or former President Trump, that would be a good thing for you. Liz from Austin says, a lot of these problems you mentioned could be solved if rich people got their heads out of their you-know-whats and stopped being so greedy.
Well, I mean, Massachusetts voters decided to do something about that with the surtax that went into effect 2 days ago. By the way, Marjorie touched the televisions. One of the two of them is down.
It's back up.
You know what else? No, the other one is not working.
Oh, sorry.
You know what also is not working? The phone lines.
Oh, the phone lines.
Did you touch the phone lines?
I did not touch the phone lines.
I know. Well, you're pointing to the sign and says, because phone line's not working, no calls yet?
That's not what it says.
Oh, it doesn't. It says that on my thing.
Oh, okay.
In any case, 877, why am I giving the phone number when you can't call? But you can text 877-301-8970. Oh, they are working now. Well, that's fine. 877-301-8970. A year when, here's the percentage positive. You ready for this? Predictions for 2023. A year when taxes will rise, only 18% are positive. A year of economic prosperity, only 20%. I mean, this is really unbelievable. And I would argue, you know, who was I reading last night? Oh, Howard Dean was on CNN last night and said that Joe Biden's had a terrific 2 years. And if you think about it, legislatively, it's about as successful a couple of years as a president has had,
at least in our recent life.
The perception, exactly.
Yeah.
Gas prices are coming down, and they were the sort of the symbol of the economic crisis. I know there may be a recession in 2023. Again, new young leaders here. I would argue the divided Congress is going to be a nightmare. Nothing is going to get done. There's just going to be fighting.
Well, I think the federal situation is very depressing to people because they see that this is not, you know, we're going to go in, I'm going to do investigations. Now of Hunter Biden and his computer. And
I don't think that's inappropriate, by the way. It shouldn't be the major focus of the new Congress.
He may have done some very bad things.
Yeah, he might have. I don't know
but
if he did
I just
or not.
Don't think that's going to change anybody's life in any significant way. And if it isn't tied to President Biden, it doesn't really matter that much.
But the Supreme Court is in really good hands, so we feel good about that. They're headed in a good direction.
But you do think that I mean, we've talked about this a lot with guests, that things may be really a mess federally, but states can do some things, and states have done some things in terms of ballot questions and voting that I think surprised lots of people. Anyway, let's go to Pat in Somerville. Thank you for calling, Pat.
Hi there, Pat.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Thank you for having me. I just wanted to say that, I feel a little pessimistic about the sort of economic downturn of the country. I feel that I make more money, but ultimately I can spend it on less things because the prices not only went up, but everything has also shrank. But I feel very cautiously optimistic about the direction that Massachusetts is taking, and like new leadership gets me very excited and like pretty heard as an immigrant. Like I've been here for 12 years, and I can say that this is the first time, like, okay, we're actually moving in a better direction than we were before.
Pat, unfortunately, I got to let you go because the connection is bad, but we got the gist of it. He's another one who feels Massachusetts is going in a good direction. By the way, at 2 o'clock today, Charlie Baker is giving, I guess it's his final speech.
Yeah.
2 o'clock today, he will be giving his final speech. Tomorrow, there's some ceremony, and then obviously, as of Thursday, the new governor is Maura Healey, and you heard that Brandi Carlile, who's fabulous, is going to be headlining a thing at the Garden.
I am so tired of being pessimistic, says Denise from Marlboro, so I'm committed to being optimistic. I have to, or life will become more dismal. I look forward to our new leaders in the state and seeing Kevin McCarthy being humiliated. That has been entertaining. Jasper from Marlboro says, the bar is
love
very
name,
low
Jasper.
This year. If I survive college and get a better job, then I'm good.
You know what no one's mentioned so far, which also puts a pull over a lot of things, turning on your television at night and seeing the situation in Ukraine. And even though, again, we continue to hear from Zelensky and advisors, the Ukrainians are taking this to the Russians are losing, as we discussed with Charlie Sennett yesterday, it's going to be a pretty bleak winter over there. And I hope and think that a lot of people in this country feel a deep connection to the people there who've shown resilience and courage that I think most of us don't have. Regina in Walpole, you're next on Boston Public Radio, live at the Boston Public Library. Welcome.
Hi, thank you very much.
Thank you.
One thing I'm very optimistic about is that Maura Healey will now be our governor.
She will.
I think she's a remarkable woman. She's smart. She's articulate. She has honesty and justice. I'm thrilled. And I hope after one or two terms, she'll run for president and be the first woman president in our country.
Whoa.
There you go.
Well, there you go is right. Regina, thank you for the call.
That was
call.
Very optimistic. Listen to Amber from Worcester. This is a very good point, actually, by Amber from Worcester. I am optimistic that Gen Z will continue to be engaged. They really helped in the midterms and hopeful that 2023 will see the end of Trump in whatever fashion that might be. You know, that's a good point, too, because Gen Z is very concerned, obviously, because they're young about climate. And I think that's a big thing that they got involved in the political process, because I think it does obviously matter who is elected to
office. You know what's mentioned almost not at all in the narrative that goes along with this Gallup? So I didn't read the whole thing. It's pretty thick, but I read a lot of it. You know who's not mentioned at all in there, but maybe I guess he's subsumed within the negative perception of the political environment is Trump.
Yeah.
Maybe people feel he's on the run, but you would think that'd be a cause for optimism, even if he's about to be replaced by the B team, the McCarthys and the DeSantises and people like that. Speaking of DeSantis, by the way, Santos will be sworn in today, as far as we know. And since we saw you yesterday, we're going to discuss this briefly with Juliette Kayyem. The Brazilian authorities, in the proceeding that Santos
Bolsonaro
says he had nothing to do with, planned to proceed against him for him writing $700 on a stolen checking account. And while he says today he had nothing to do with it, apparently he admitted at the time that he did do it and wanted to repay the merchant, but apparently his story has changed.
Well, you know, that's part of the reason I think people are so depressed, isn't it? That Kevin McCarthy, who is a total soulless, gutless, disgraceful person, is going to be heading up the House.
Maybe. I'm not sure he's going to be heading up the House.
And that Santos is going to be sworn in. I mean, it's like the lack of shame is sort of shocking.
By the way, the shame part of this, we're not going to spend the whole day talking about McCarthy, even though it's a big day for him. I assume everybody listening knows that McCarthy on January 6th was one of the people who spoke the truth.
Right.
This is on Donald Trump. It's his fault that what happened today happened. And then days later, you see a picture of him like he's at Disney World standing next to Donald Trump, I think with that pathetic thumbs up. I'm not sure if they're doing the thumbs
up
thing.
And you know what?
Like a little boy.
And the reason he's not going to say anything about Santos, of course, is because Santos says he's going to vote for him.
Of course.
You know, would it be a disaster if the Republicans had Steve Scalise as the leader of the House? I don't think so.
Well, you know, the irony of this, I think a lot of people are losing.
He'd probably be better.
A lot of our texters are regaling themselves in the fact that McCarthy may lose. If he loses, he loses because he's not right-wing enough. How much more right-wing can you possibly get? So before you all are celebrating, that's your one piece of optimism. Be careful, what you're celebrating. 877-301-8970. I'm looking at the text quickly. There's a lot of optimism about Healy and Campbell and Wu and the whole spectrum of new women leaders. By the way, your TV is now not working again.
Oh, sorry.
It's okay.
Oh, that's because they're having the monthly testing thing.
Oh,
they're
they are. That's fine. Test. Thank you for telling me that.
So listen. So this is a good one, too.
Yeah.
Mental health legislation. This is the one with the new number you can call up and actually probably get a real human being on there.
Mm-hmm.
A texter said it will... is hoping for better access for all and less wait time for beds. That's a big thing.
Do we book that woman? Is that woman coming on later this week from the National Association? We have somebody from the National Association of Social Workers booked later this week who's going to delve into the details of this fabulous new helpline and these 25 centers where people with mental health issues can call or go. Hopefully, to get care in a much more expedited kind of fashion. We just learned about that yesterday through the Globe, and it's a great thing.
We have an anti-abortion person who's emailed several times thinking there's going to be an end of abortion in the United States in 2023. I don't think so. I think that's exactly the opposite of where people showed they were in the last vote about that. Even people that are anti-abortion did not want a complete ban on abortion.
Well, you know, I'm not even sure, beyond the fact that it couldn't get through the Senate, I'm not even sure there are enough Republican votes to pass such legislation even in the House, you know, because they only have a 5-vote majority. What did McCarthy say?
Well, we can play it.
Let's
I haven't had time
it.
To read it.
This, Here
he
it
just
is.
Came out unannounced to make a media appearance before Congress goes into session. Here's what he had to say.
Last night I was presented the only way to have 218 votes. If I provided certain members with certain positions, certain gavels, to take over the church committee, to have certain budgets, and they even came to the position where one, Matt Gaetz, said, I don't care if we go to plurality and we elect Hakeem Jeffries and it hurts the new frontline members not to get reelected. Well, that's not about America, and I will always fight to put the American people first.
So what do you read
do you
into that? I have no idea what his point
is. Do you understand
what
he's talking
about? No, I don't. Well, I assume, yeah. Matt Gaetz, who no one has explained to me why he was not indicted for that little sex trafficking thing with minors in Florida. I think what he's saying is I don't have the votes, and he's trying to shame Gaetz and some of these other people. They're amongst the five who said they are never McCarthyites. To vote for them, I guess, because they may end up with a Democrat as the Speaker of the House, even though they have a majority.
Here's a good text.
Unlikely.
I lived through the 60s, assassinations, riots, the anti-war movement splintered into bombings and killings worldwide, Nixon disgraced and resigned, Vietnam ends horribly for everyone, the world changed, our country survived. Optimism? Greta Thunberg, one person can change the world. How about that?
That's a good one. Here's another one. I'm optimistic that Elon Musk will lose $200 billion in 2023. Did you see on Drudge, there was a story yesterday, he's the first person in the history of the world to lose $200
billion.
So he's only got $150 billion left. I assume that's cause for celebration.
Our number is 877-301-8970. We're talking about your attitude going into 2023. The Gallup pollsters say that Americans are largely pessimistic about the United States prospects in 2023. Democrats are the least pessimistic. Republicans are the most pessimistic, and independents are in the middle. What do you think about 2023? And what are you optimistic about in 2023? You're listening to 89.7 GBH, Boston Public Radio. We are broadcasting live from the Boston Public Library, and we are streaming on youtube.com/GBH News.
Support for NPR comes from NPR stations. Other contributors include Procter & Gamble, maker of Metamucil, a fiber supplement containing psyllium, a plant-based fiber for trapping and removing waste in the digestive system, designed to be taken every day. More at Metamucil.com.
Local politics. Trusted local reporters.
I try to explain the big questions that people in government are wrestling with.
Political reporter Adam Riley.
But I also try to explain where the people who are making those decisions are coming from, what beliefs they might have that are causing them to make certain decisions as opposed to other ones. The policies are important, but the people behind the policies are important too and fascinating.
The GBH News Politics Team.
Support for GBH comes from you and United Healthcare, providing health plan coverage options for New England businesses and their employees. You can learn more at UHC.com. That's UHC.com. And Sunbug Solar, a full-service local solar energy company helping to grow renewable energy in Massachusetts since 2009. To learn more about current solar energy employment opportunities, visit sunbugsolar.com.
Welcome back to Boston Public Radio. Jim Browdy and Marjorie Egan live from the Boston Public Library, streaming at youtube.com/GBH News. If you're just tuning in, we're talking about our outlooks for 2023. Are you among the overwhelming 90% of Americans who say they're pessimistic about the year ahead in a new Gallup poll? And if so, can you dig deep and find at least something to to look forward to. Give us a buzz or a text at 877-301-8970. You know, we mentioned, before we get back to the callers and the texters, yesterday we spent most of our day discussing two people. We discussed George Santos and we discussed Pope Benedict.
That's right.
And in light of Pope Benedict, I received a text yesterday afternoon I'd like to share with you.
Oh.
Marjorie and I, during the sex abuse crisis, which we talked about a lot on the air on our prior show, we were very fortunate to meet a woman. The bad news was she was a survivor of all this. The good news, one of the best people I think we've ever met. Well, she texted me yesterday. Here's what she said, Marjorie.
What'd she say?
She said, at a conference in June, I went up to Marjorie, said my name, and hugged her and began chatting. She'd texted me the previous day saying she was looking forward to seeing me. I had a big yellow name tag around my neck. She seemed a little off to me. Then after 10 minutes of talking, Marjorie said, I have to go find Christine. I asked, Christine who? Her reply, Christine Hickey. Now, here's your question. Who was the person who texted me?
Christine Hickey.
That is exactly
she
correct.
She looked different, though. I forget what
well,
it was.
She said she lost a few pounds she colored her hair.
So she looked
but
different.
But she was wearing a huge name tag.
Flummoxed. Well, I mean, you know what the problem with name tags is?
Yeah.
You have to look down.
It wasn't on her breast, she said.
Yeah,
it was lower.
You need a name tag on the forehead. That's where you need the name tag so you can see them while you're talking to them.
Yeah.
That's what I would say, Jim.
Well,
anyway,
in any case, did you find Christine Hickey or you didn't?
I did. She said, tis I, actually.
Tis I, actually. 877-301-8970. Yeah. By the way, this is an interesting text. This person, but it's not, we don't have his or her name. So they say, do not put this on air, but we can. I'm concerned there may be a move to put Trump in his speaker. Ouch, ouch, ouch. Do you know what I learned in the last couple of years? I didn't know this. Do you know you don't need to be a member of the House of Representatives to be the speaker? So if there could be unity around making Donald Trump the Speaker of the House, he could be the Speaker of the House of Representatives.
He could be the Speaker of the House of Representatives. There was some indication earlier on that he was actually thinking about it. Roger from Putnam reminds us that you mentioned this already, but there is this bill called the Santos Act.
The acronym is S-A-N-T-O-S. I can't remember what it stands for. Richie Torres. Oh, sorry.
Stop Another Non-Truthful Office Seeker. So there is considerable opposition.
By the way that would work, just so people know, and I don't know what the consequence of this be, if you're running for federal office, you'd have to sign under oath that what you were alleging in your resume was factually accurate. So let's assume that Santos had done that. It was not factually accurate. What's the consequence for violating the oath? I mean, I assume it's not ejection from Congress if you're elected by the people. And if it's not, what does that achieve?
I don't know. Is that perjury? Lying under oath?
That's an interesting question. So what's the consequence of that?
I don't know. I mean, you could be charged with perjuring yourself. I don't know. But a lot of people are going to be charged with perjuring themselves, I think, after this January 6th revelations of people being less than truthful, particularly that guy that was the ex-Secret Service man that claimed he seemed to know nothing about the former president lunging at the Secret Service agent in the car the day of the riot on the way to the Ellipse, or not on the way to the Ellipse, was where the president, or from the Ellipse, I should say, the president wanted to go down to the Capitol. There could be people, I assume they were...
I don't know what the consequence is.
Under oath, were
we'll
they
check
not?
It. Well, I so assume they were, yeah. Gretchen and Natick, you're next on Boston Public Radio. Thank you much for calling. Hi.
Hi, Jim and Marjorie. Love tuning in to you guys every
Thank
morning.
Thank you so much.
On my way to Worcester.
Very nice
of
you.
I'm a social worker and a community-based mental health clinic.
Good.
Teenagers.
Oh, we agree. Gretchen,
yeah,
we lost you after you said what you did for a living. Tell us, go back to the beginning. What are you?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, so I'm a social worker, and I work at a community-based mental health clinic in Worcester.
Great.
And I work with children and teenagers. And my optimism for this coming year, I talk to my colleagues about this a lot. I really think that this generation is more loving, caring, and compassionate to one another than any generation we've seen before.
Really?
Just the amount of empathy that I see in these teenagers who put their arms around their fellow LGBTQ peers or peers that are struggling with mental health issues. I just have so much hope that our society is moving in a positive direction when it comes to understanding one another.
Well, yeah,
I am
that's
so glad you called,
call.
Gretchen. And, you know, I think that is a great point. When you think of the baby boomers, how we discriminated against almost everybody, religion, certainly people that were gay and lesbian, it has really changed dramatically. What do you make of that? Why?
You know, I think that there's just been more amazing leaders and people in these communities people of color, people in the LGBTQ community who have been brave enough to have their voices be heard, whether it's in television, whether it's in media, through books. And the youth are absorbing that and seeing that, you know, this is something that we can embrace, and this is something that there's no need to be discriminatory towards these folks. And they're coming out in the schools, too, and the counselors and teachers, you know, really embrace it and say, okay, that's the name you want to go by. That's what we're calling you. And I think just across the board, even in faith communities, you see in NAIDIC, we've got pride flags, Black Lives Matter flags outside of large churches.
Yeah.
Well, you know, Gretchen, we're really, really glad you called. On almost every issue that I care about, and I assume you as well, young people are so much more enlightened than are we. You know, the flip side of that is there's some brutal honesty from young people. I don't know if he'd said this to us on the radio or on TV. David Hogg from Parkland, who obviously has done remarkable things. He's now at Harvard.
Yeah.
We were talking about young people and how critical they were, and obviously he and his fellow students have been otherworldly great on a whole bunch of things relating to guns. And I said, but to get to the, how do we ever get to the place where we get gun legislation that is sane, that gets rid of things like semi-automatic weapons? And he turned to me, I guess it was on television, he turned to me, and he said, just matter-of-factly, when your generation dies, we'll get there.
That's right. When we're dead.
I don't think he meant it quite as crassly, but that is probably true.
Although I'm not going to go 6 feet under now. I'm going to be mulched. I've been reading more and more about mulching.
I heard about that, too. They did that this morning on the morning show on our station.
Correct. Yeah, you can be mulched.
Do you really want to do
that?
You're really okay with that?
Well, I've not really extensively looked into it, Jim.
They could put you in the wood chipper, like Fargo, or whatever it was.
Exactly. And then you could be, like, you know, under a big, huge pile of mulch and for the duration.
Do you not worry about what happens to your body when you're...
You're either eaten by the worms or you're burned to smithereens in a crematorium. So I don't know. Is mulch
what if they're
so
wrong,
bad?
By the way?
What, are you going to pop back to life? Jim?
It's happened.
What you're
do you
about?
Know that it's happened?
Yeah, I'm
Let's
not,
do one
I'm
more call.
About that. Okay.
Diane in Fairhaven, you're next on Boston Public Radio. Thank you for calling. Hi.
Okay, hi.
Hi, Diane.
I'm optimistic, like the caller from Worcester.
Mm-hmm.
My 26-year-old son is high-functioning on the autism spectrum, mm-hmm. and he has bipolar depression, you name it.
Mm.
But he's also part of the LGBTQ plus community. And he is a strong advocate for his peers.
Mm.
And he's always been. And he gives them support, and he helps them get through and talk to a doctor about this, that, or the other thing. And they've just bonded at what they call Better Community Living. It's in Dartmouth. And he's a big part of that. And he does demonstrations. And he gets his peers to realize what the Republicans want to do, take away their rights as human beings, basically. So anyway, I'm very, very proud of him and very optimistic. And because he's doing a great job, and there are so many out there that do it as well.
You know, Diane, you've called us a lot, and we really are fond of you. I don't think you've ever talked to us about your son, and the pride in your voice came through today. It was pretty great. Thanks for sharing that story.
You met him once. We were at the library. You met him once.
Oh, we did?
Oh, we did. Oh, I remember. Well, we took a picture with him.
Pre-COVID.
Yeah, yeah. We took a picture with him,
didn't
we?
Oh, Diane, that's great. My apologies for forgetting.
Yeah.
That's fabulous. Thanks, and I hope to talk to you again soon.
I'm so glad Diane called and the social worker called, because it's really dramatically different for young people, and I think it makes it very difficult for Ron DeSantis, the new darling of the Republicans, to get that far. I mean, do people really want someone, the President of the United States?
Old people vote in far greater numbers than young people vote. They voted strongly.
But old people now have their children coming out as gay, and old people now know more gay people in their families. I mean, it's a whole different thing than it was when we were young. Will from South
Remember
Boston.
The congressman who voted against the Respect for Marriage Act? And then a day or two later, went to at his son's same-sex wedding.
Well, these convictions are not very deeply held. We all saw after these ballot questions where people were voting to keep abortion legal.
Mm-hmm.
Suddenly, these life begins at conception. Republicans decided that maybe
change the websites.
Begin
right.
at
You're
conception
right.
after all. But listen to this from Will from South Boston. We wish him well because he says he's optimistic about the Republican Party tearing themselves apart between Trump and DeSantis. But on a personal note, says Will, my girlfriend and I will be moving in together, which I'm also very optimistic about.
Excellent note,
Good
Dan.
Good luck. Good luck,
Good
Bill.
Luck to you, indeed.
Okay. Coming up, we're going to be talking to Trenna Casey from NBC Sports Boston. You may have seen it last night, this horrible moment at last night's Bills-Bengals game when DeMar Hamlin suffered what appeared to be cardiac arrest after he tackled another player. He's now in critical condition. We're going to talk about that. Another sports news with Trenna Casey. You're listening to Boston Public Radio, 89.7 GBH. We are broadcasting live from the Boston Public Library, and we are streaming live on youtube.com/GBHnews.
I'm Marco Werman. The World's Newsroom brings you the big picture stories and some other stuff.
The whole of Niagara Falls is ripping over my right shoulder. As an ice climber, it's the largest, wildest thing I could think of climbing, and it's never been climbed. So I'm really happy to have had the opportunity to go and stick an ice tool into it.
Join us and hear the world.
This afternoon at 3, here on GBH News 89.7.
Funding for our programs comes from you.
And National Grid, providing access to electric heat pumps, which offer heating and cooling for businesses of all sizes to help them achieve their sustainability goals. You can learn more about heat pump technology at ngrid.com/future. And the Museum of Fine Arts Boston, celebrating the legacy of Martin Luther King Jr. with free admission for Massachusetts residents on Monday, January 16th, in partnership with Citizens. Learn more at mfa.org/MLK Day.
Welcome back to Boston Public Radio. Jim Browdy, Mardrigan, live at the Boston Public Library, streaming at youtube.com/GBHnews. We're joined by Trenna Casey. Trenna's an anchor and reporter with NBC Sports Boston and a BPR contributor. Hello, Trenna.
Happy New Year, guys.
And to you.
Happy New Year, too. Well, let's start with this unfolding, we hope, not a tragedy, involving player DeMar Hamlin, who tackled another player and then fell backwards and went into cardiac arrest?
Yeah, I actually didn't watch it in real time. And I found a clip on Twitter last night, and I kept watching it, trying to figure out what would have caused that kind of physical reaction. T. Higgins, a wide receiver, caught a pass from quarterback Joe Burrow of the Bengals. DeMar Hamlin, who is a safety for the Buffalo Bills, tackled him. T. Higgins did hit him sort of in the chest and the shoulder. He fell backwards
with
his
helmet.
With his helmet, got right back up, yep, and then stumbled backwards, fell to the ground. That was about, I think, 8:55 p.m. He was administered when they checked on him. He was not breathing. He did not have a pulse. They administered CPR. There are also reports that they used a defibrillator on him. They did get his heart beating back on the football field. He was then transported to the only level one trauma center at the University of Cincinnati in Cincinnati, where he is now still listed as in critical condition. He was intubated and sedated last night. The most recent update we have is from his marketing manager, who is there with his family. He told Robin Roberts on Good Morning America today that he is a fighter. He is fighting this. The family is optimistic that they're just taking it hour by hour, minute by minute. But other than that, we have no update on his condition. The last formal update from the Buffalo Bills that we got last night was, I would say, around maybe 11:30 or midnight.
You know, I wasn't listening to it live either, and then I just started listening to the radio after it happened. And as someone, me, who has nothing good ever to say about the NFL, I said to myself, you know, the fact that they even postponed this game,
yeah,
shows that. However, I then wake up to this sound from Joe Buck from ESPN, who's one of the announcers on the game and obviously is in constant contact with the NFL,
yes,
leadership. Here he is repeatedly during the broadcast saying the league had initially given word the game would be suspended only for 5 minutes, which the NFL now denies. Here's Buck.
They'll have 5 minutes to warm up. And Troy, I mean, first of all, I've never seen anything like this. And then, Lisa, as we said, they've been given 5 minutes to, quote unquote, get ready to go back to playing. That's the word we get from the league and the word we get from down on the field. But nobody's moving. Then when we got the update that within 5 minutes these players were going to start playing football again, we saw Zach Taylor live walk across the field to Sean McDermott. Players were being told that they would have 5 minutes to get back ready for play.
Taylor and McDermott, by the way, the two coaches, and Lisa's Lita Solders, who's the sideline reporter. I mean, it's pretty obvious the NFL wanted to continue the game, and ultimately they realized it would be a total humiliation for the league. No?
Well, I also think it's not that it would be humiliation for the league. I think what happened, and listen, I rarely stick up for the NFL, but in this instance, you know, I hate to say this, but how many times just this year in a game against the Detroit Lions at Gillette Stadium, a player went down, was unconscious, taken off of on a stretcher on an ambulance, and there was a significant delay of the game between the Lions and the Patriots, and they continued playing. So unfortunately, these types of things happen in the NFL, and more often than not, in fact, every time, this is the first time a game has ever been suspended, so I understand where the league was coming from. Let's regroup, let's get back out there. They always go back and play. Where I will give the league credit is that, and I will give the players, the Bills, and the Bengals credit for being honest with the league, saying, listen, this is different. We saw our teammate, our friend, being administered paddles, defibrillator.
And they were crying.
They were crying on the field.
A lot of them, and hugging each other.
I'm sorry. You're being, with all due respect, charitable. You talk about others, and those circumstances are right. But it's interesting. The players, the competing coaches, all of these entities that are used to continuing a game, they realized the game couldn't continue.
And then
did. But why wasn't the NFL at the lead of the pack rather than following lead?
My guess is that the people that were there realized immediately that he might be dying. And that's different than even
than somebody sitting in New York.
And you think the National Football League didn't know?
Well, I mean, other situations. Remember the famous Joe Theismann thing with the bone through the leg and the blood everywhere and all that
disgusting
kind of stuff? But he wasn't dying. And I thought that was the reaction, that the horrified look on these players' faces when they realized it. That's what pushed it over the edge.
To me, like, this is something, again, unfortunately happens. What I don't like the lying and the gaslighting the
day
after.
That's a very good point.
To me, listen, you are it's human nature. You've responded one way for, 50, 60, how long has the NFL been around? 100 years you've responded the same way. This is an incident that has never happened, not since the 70s on a football field when a player for the Lions actually died on the field. This has never happened
before. They didn't suspend that game?
I don't know, because I mean, it was before I was born. I was like, just kind of, but I don't know. Maybe they probably didn't, Jim. They probably didn't. It's the NFL. So to me, the NFL took their time with this. They listened to players. What I don't like is Troy Vincent, the president of the NFLPA today, making excuses, even though Joe Buck is not making this up. Listen, I've worked game broadcast before. I've never worked in I have worked in NFL game broadcast before.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it was like preseason for back when in the Packers years. But yes, I worked sidelines for NFL in college. You never report anything about the status of a game that is delayed. Major League Baseball, NBA, whatever it is, you do not report anything without hearing it from the league. So Joe Buck is not going to go on ESPN. He is a grizzled veteran and say, we are hearing from the league.
So
they are getting that information from the league. So for Troy Vincent then to come back and say, no, well, of course we would never, just say, in the moment, I would rather have you just say, in the moment, this to us was like a number of other incidents we unfortunately experience in our game where someone is seriously injured, they are carted off in an ambulance, 9 times out of 10 we continue with the game. But after speaking with our players and the coaches, we deemed that it was absolutely necessary in this instance to cancel the game. Because again, you're trying, we can all sit here and say, well, I would have called the game right away, but we don't know what we would have done in that particular situation. I just don't like trying to make it seem like it's
like, ask
like
you something.
What actually happened didn't happen.
This was a very big game, obviously.
Huge.
So there was money involved here. You know,
gambling, yes. I mean, every game has gambling involved. I mean,
well, they're going to play it. It isn't
canceled.
Postponed. It'll just be postponed.
But,
yeah.
But I'm wondering about the money aspect. I mean, did it cost them millions of dollars to postpone this thing?
I don't know the answer to that. I'm sure that there is some.
They're insured. I mean,
it's not only that, but like ESPN prepays for Monday Night Football. It's not like now the NFL has to hand them back a portion of it.
Okay.
But there is complications. We don't know for sure that they will replay this game. It is possible. So we're at the end of the season here. It's not like this happened in week 3. You have bye weeks. You have some flexibility and manipulation with the schedule. The Bills are scheduled to play the Patriots Sunday afternoon in Buffalo at 1 p.m. The Bengals, forgive me, I can't remember who the Bengals have to play, but both of these teams are jockeying for position along with the Kansas City Chiefs in the AFC playoffs. So there are playoff implications. If the Bills would have won last night and then beat the Patriots on Sunday, or if the Chiefs lost on Saturday, the Bills are the number one seed in the AFC. They get a bye, they get a week off. So there's a lot of other factors. And you're certainly, let's say they play the game tomorrow or they play the game on Wednesday. Are you, after everything that's happened, there was also a concussion on the field earlier in the first quarter where a player got taken off for the Bills. A defensive back was taken off of the field and could not return to the game for a concussion. You have to be mindful of all of these things and making guys, what are you going to play on a Wednesday and then play again at 1 o'clock on a Sunday? But further complicating matters is that the playoffs begin next Saturday and the national championship in college football is Monday night, and the NFL is not allowed to play a game while the national championship game is happening.
Okay, so there are a lot of factors. A corollary of this thing is, other than boxing and MMA or whatever it's called, is there any more violent sport than football? This is not an argument. I can't think of one.
I mean, no, but this okay, wasn't. So okay. But I will say that this incident is not because of football.
It is because of football. Doesn't mean there was not a pre-existing something.
What? Somebody said last night, it's like getting into 9 or 10 car accidents every game you play.
It is.
But here's my question.
But my point, Jim, that this actually happens. What happened last night on the field has happened numerous times in lacrosse matches, to the point where lacrosse actually now requires all of their players to wear chest protectors. They had a player die from Cornell University, a senior. I sent all these stories earlier today for you guys to take a look at, because this is the one thing, the narrative that I don't want to happen, is that this happened because it's football. This is something that is a freak accident that happened in hockey to Chris Pronger.
It did happen because it was football.
But
it doesn't mean
one time in football.
I agree, but let me just finish the thought. It's also a sport where there are tons of concussions that lead to horrible outcomes. And the question I wanted to ask is, when you were a parent of athletic kids, my kids did kung fu, but that was about it. Your kids, all three, played competitive sports. Well, they do actually. It's Walam Kung Fu in Chinatown here. But the question is, you're the parent now, not of late 20s and early 30s like your kids are. Right. You're the parents of 10-year-olds now, including one boy. Do you let your kid play football?
I didn't let him play then because I didn't like Pop Warner then. I mean, he started.
So why
at
would
like
it,
8
why
years
would
old.
Any
people
why?
Jim, you be, I have friends who are doctors. They know all the risks. They see what happens, and their kids play football.
I don't get it.
Now they coach them because I think they see a benefit of teaching them proper tackling techniques. I have so many friends who are smart and are thoughtful and obviously care about their children. But
what's the benefit of learning a proper?
But here's the other thing.
Well, in rugby, there's proper tackling techniques you don't see as often, sort of like the concussions.
It's
different. You don't wear helmets and things like that. Yeah. Football is a violent, fast sport.
Yeah. What were we going to say?
But here's the thing, as you mentioned, that I remember the guy from the Herald. It was his son. He got hit with a hockey puck in the chest.
Yes.
And his heart stopped. And my son, I took him out of football, ended up getting such a bad concussion playing basketball that he couldn't play sports for a year and a half.
I will say, the
so
difference,
you never
though, about
know.
Concussions is concussions happen.
They don't kill you.
Well, no, but
they do kill you.
Sporadic. Well, they're sporadic in sports like basketball.
Right.
They're sporadic in sports. Even like, I mean, they're more prevalent in soccer, but soccer now adjusted things. So where I do agree with Jim is when we're talking about things like concussions, then yes, football is extraordinarily dangerous. This particular instance is not a football problem. Concussions to me are a football.
I agree with that. It's not a football
problem.
Football caused it in this instance.
Yes,
it is not
a football
problem. In any case, I wish we had time today to hear from parents about whether or not this is what's happened in the NFL. Not just this, the quarterback, obviously, from Miami Dolphins.
Yeah,
how many concussions this year? Three in a year?
Well, they say two, but it looks more like
three.
And they let him. I don't know if you watched, but his head slammed against the ground, which happens in football, but he was playing my Green Bay Packers. And I'll be honest, I watched the play. It didn't even dawn on me that he should come off the field.
How about when you watch it after the fact?
Neurologist.
The back of his head bouncing off the damn turf.
It's horrible.
And to his credit, he went to the Dolphins the next day and said, I don't feel well. I need to be evaluated. It wasn't even the Dolphins. The player had to go to the team and say, I didn't feel well.
Let's see if Mark can do a transition to Tom Brady.
I am doing a transition to Tom Brady. Not just Tom Brady, Aaron Rodgers. You're out there
with
Green Bay Packers. The geezer stars, you know, out there.
I know.
Aaron Rodgers and Tom Brady had a great weekend. Here we have, a montage, actually, from Tom Brady's triple touchdown passes. Now, they were way behind once again.
14-0, 21-7 or 21-3.
At the halftime. And I believe most of this happened in the fourth quarter.
Did.
Yes.
Unbelievable. Anyway, here are the triple touchdown passes coming from behind in the fourth quarter to wide receiver Mike Evans Sunday when the Tampa Bay Buccaneers were playing against the Panthers.
Brady throws a deep pass toward Evans, near sideline. He makes the catch of the 10. 5-3-2-1. Touchdown, Tampa Bay.
Good snap to Brady. Kicks the shoulder. Looks downfield. Throws the ball down the right. He's got Evans. Evans makes the catch of the 20. To the 10. To the 5. Touchdown, Tampa Bay. Toward the end zone. Evans. Under it. Bay makes the catch. Touchdown, Tampa Bay. Evans has 3. Fire the cannons. Fire them.
45.
And didn't he do a quarterback sneak of a yard or two?
He did.
Yeah. Because he's Tom Brady.
So once again.
He's fine with his kids playing football, by the way.
Well,
his male son.
He has been, knocked down many times in football, but he has miraculously, that's what's so nerve-wracking about him. You keep thinking he's going to get one hit and that's going to be it.
But also we say he miraculously has been fine. He's whatever. He's got the pliability. What is he going to be like in 5, 10, 15 years?
I don't know.
That's a good question.
You know, I mean, just because somebody seems fine and normal while they're playing the game.
That's right.
Like you talk to a lot of former players where these issues don't crop up until a few years after, they're done playing.
Well, that's the question.
And just because we don't outwardly see him having any issues doesn't mean, like, who knows what he's experiencing.
Didn't Bunchen say that he had concussions even though he denied it?
It was part of a big reason, I think, that caused a rift in their marriage that she was very worried about his long-term health.
Don't people in jiu-jitsu get concussions? Isn't she dating some jiu-jitsu guy?
Oh, she is, actually. Only you would know.
Well, yeah, I would guess so, because you're kicking people in the head, right?
And he's much younger than she is.
Well, good for her.
Go,
you
Giselle.
Are so superficial.
Good
it
for
is
her.
Pathetic.
I think Tom Brady's new girlfriend is also much younger than her.
Oh,
he has
really?
A new girlfriend?
I heard he does. Every time Google it, though, I can't find anything. I just keep hearing he has a new young girlfriend. Yes.
Oh, we don't know anything more than that?
But it's not as exciting when a man has a young girlfriend, because older men always date younger women.
That's right.
It's much more exciting when an older woman is dating a younger man, because that's like an anomaly.
How old is Bunchen? Like 40 older women? How old is she?
She's 43. But if she's 43 and she's dating someone who's in their 20s, trust me,
maybe
Jim, back when I was on the dating apps, I wasn't exactly getting sniffs from 28-year-olds.
Maybe he's only 22.
You know, can we talk about an 82? Can we move on? I don't want to talk about Tom Brady's dates. Can we talk about an 82-year-old?
Oh, Jim, you're so boring.
I lived in New York City when Pele, who died at 82 the other day, played for the New York Cosmos. And so I got to see occasionally a little something here. I didn't go to a game, but I saw
it. Kind of like seeing David Beckham or someone end of a career, but still.
Well, I knew he was good, even though I didn't know that much about soccer. Let me tell you, after he died, if you went online, which I assume everybody did, and watched the greatest hits or greatest...
He's unbelievable.
Even though we spent all this time talking about the brilliance of the player for France, the brilliance of the player for Argentina in the World Cup, I've never seen anybody play a sport like he played a sport. Did you watch some of these clips?
It's unbelievable. I mean, obviously he didn't, I didn't grow up in his generation of soccer, but like the fact that he is an athlete who is simply known by one name.
Yeah,
like, I don't care if you may know nothing about sports, but you know who Pele is.
Yeah, you do.
You know that he is a Brazilian soccer superstar, that he changed the game, that he really changed soccer and made it a worldwide phenomenon. I mean, I'm not sure if you guys saw the pictures from Brazil yesterday for his 24
Oh, he's lying at the...
He's lying. Yeah. He's lying
in Santos, right? Is that where he is in Brazil?
He's
hometown.
Lying in state.
That's a stadium where he played.
Which is unbelievable. Like, that's what he meant to that not just that, that city or town that he grew up in, but the entire country.
You know, I want to tell a little story that I learned this morning, and if I get part of it wrong, which I think I will, I hope one of the two of you correct me.
It's about Giselle?
It's not about Giselle. I wouldn't get any of that wrong. So he's playing his last game for the New York Cosmos. He comes to America, makes $1 million a year, which is unheard of at that time. And the last game is against his hometown team of Santos. Two things interesting happen. He plays the first half for the New York Cosmos. The second half, he switches and plays for his home. It gives me chills even thinking about it. And then at the end, he's leading the crowd in a chant. The crowd has obviously gone wild for a soccer player. And remember what they're chanting? Love, love, love is what they're chanting from the stands.
Love.
I don't know. That was the Beatles, not him. But
love,
in any case,
maybe
I don't know
song,
anything
then.
About his personal life or stuff. But it sounds like in addition to being a brilliant athlete, he was also an incredibly decent human being who really cared about people. It's a beautiful story.
He certainly isn't someone that when you read about him, you know, sometimes when someone famous dies, you know, and rightfully so, the articles that are written talk about all aspects of their life. Kobe Bryant comes to mind. Mm-hmm. And it's disappointing when they don't cover the broad spectrum of the good and the bad. For him, everything is nothing. Yeah. It's like a Bill Russell, right? I mean, this is someone who, again, who changed an entire sport. Changed an entire sport.
Well, I had estrogen rising this week when Barbara Walters died at 93 years old. And talk about someone who changed the whole industry.
For women.
And never got the credit for it. She was made fun of on Saturday Night Live for years. Barbara Wawa. What kind of
By the way, I got text last night from friends. When you were ridiculing me, saying I was Harry Reasoner incarnate, or Hugh Downs. I thought that story of yours was made up. Could you tell that story again?
The story was that when she first got on to be a co-host on the Today Show, she could not ask a question until the male co-host had asked three questions. And then
Not surprising.
She could ask a question after that. And I don't think she could introduce any of the guests or ask any of the first questions. Although some people would say somebody else doesn't get to introduce any guests. Have you noticed that, Trudy?
Oh, wow.
Thank you.
Wow.
Okay, I'm sorry I brought it up. Thank you. Thank you very much.
No, but
you
know what? You ask the first three questions.
But actually, she gets asked the first question.
Let me just say one more thing. Because you know, Harry Reasoner was so ticked off that she was his co-host.
This is when he took over. She took over the nightly news, first woman.
He was horrible to her. The people in the studio were horrible to her. The people that worked there were horrible to her. And she persevered. And she did mention how it took a toll. She had one child, and it took a toll because she didn't get the time to spend with the children. But what people forget that it was kind of like just the facts, ma'am, in the news. That's why there was no reporting about JFK's philandering, because it was just men who were newsmen. She changed the whole business. She asked about people's
It was not
lives.
Because all the people who knew about it, those men, were buddies of JFK's, too.
No, it was because men thought that, you know, it didn't matter what you were doing. You could have 17
girlfriends. Well, that may be true, too.
That's the way it is. We're not going to get into that kind of thing.
But wasn't it a more closer a fraternity where they didn't report on the misdeeds of their, I mean, isn't the great Ben Bradley one of the people, not junior, but senior?
Senior, well, he did have a few wives.
That was my point. You always get back to that. Isn't that interesting? It always does get back
to that. No, but I just think
that
she really changed the industry. And she had The View, which people ridicule as being a ridiculous show.
But it's still going.
It's still going. It's a very popular show. And it can be a very fascinating show as well. So anyway.
I mean, Barbara Walters is one of the reasons I mean, Jane Pauley was really the reason that I wanted to become a broadcaster. She's great.
Is that true? I didn't know that.
I loved Jane Pauley. I wanted to host the Today Show.
She's still great.
She's great. CBS Sunday Morning is probably one of the best shows on television.
Very calming.
It is very calming.
It is. It's wonderful to watch.
I love watching it. She did a really lovely piece this week on Barbara Walters where she said when she replaced Barbara Walters on the Today Show, and she said people always used to say that she sounded like her, and she fought that because many people made fun of the way that Barbara Walters talked. And then she said one day she heard something in her ear, and she thought, and she said she got a little like upset because she thought Barbara Walters was back on the show and maybe it was going to like one up her and upstage her. And then she realized it was her voice.
Oh, that's a pretty great
story. It was a great story.
Remember when the last day of The View, when Barbara Walters retired from The View, Jane Pauley.
Everybody showed
all,
up.
You know,
Robin Roberts, Katie Couric.
Yep, Katie Couric, Connie Chung, all these women that had been influenced by her and helped by her and mentored by her.
There are so many people my age that never would have gotten into
Speaking of trailblazers, do you have any idea who the first woman columnist at the Boston Herald, a male bastion, was?
Marjorie Egan?
That would have been
Affirmative Action
Egan.
I was the first news woman columnist. Yeah, from an
That's a pretty big
baby.
Deal, Marjorie.
Why, was there a sportswoman columnist before you?
No, there was a weddings woman columnist kind of thing.
In retrospect, that's what you should have done.
I should have done the weddings.
Exactly.
I missed my
Jackie McMullen, Leslie Visser on the sports side.
Yeah.
A lot of local connections.
Trenny,
it's great to see you. Thank you so much.
Thanks,
Trenny
guys.
Casey.
Thank
Bye.
You very much, Trenny Casey. We've been speaking with Trenny Casey, anchor and reporter for NBC Sports Boston. Up next, George Santos lied his way to the U.S. Congress. He's going to be sworn in. Not yet, but any moment now. But now his Brazilian legal troubles are hot on his tail. Our national security expert, Juliette Kayyem, joins to discuss this and a lot more, including the suspect arrested for that horrific murder out in Idaho. You're listening to Boston Public Radio, 89.7 GBH. We are broadcasting live from the Boston Public Library and streaming on youtube.com/GBH News.
You're listening to Boston Public Radio with Jim Browdy and Marjorie Egan. Just ahead, more smart conversation about what's going on in our community. That's right after an NPR news break here on GBH News 89.7.
Our programs are made possible thanks to you and the University of Massachusetts Amherst, dedicated to environmental research to mitigate the effects of climate change and committing to power the campus with 100% renewable energy by 2032. umass.edu/sustainability. A device that seems too good to be true? Discover the story of the polygraph, a tale of noble intentions, twisted morals, and unintended consequences on American Experience, The Lie Detector, tonight at 9 on GBH2.
Trusted. Local. News. You're listening to 89.7 WGBH, HD1 Boston, online at gbhnews.org. GBH News with NPR. What matters to you.
I'm Jim Browdy, head on Boston Public Radio. We're live at the Boston Public Library with national security expert Harvard's Julia Kayyem on the four murders possibly being solved in Idaho. Then it's Gina McCarthy, the first ever White House climate advisor under President Biden. She left the administration in the fall and is now helping guide Massachusetts Governor-elect Mark Healey's transition into office. She'll join us to talk about the climate crisis, progress under Biden, and how to fight cooling climate urgency from new leaders in Congress.
I'm Marjorie Egan. What if 2023 isn't the year that the law catches up with former President Trump? It's a question we'll discuss with retired federal judge Nancy Gertner. Then, how the Cheesecake Factory laid a blueprint with their 20-page menus offering, well, everything but the kitchen sink. Our food policy expert Corby Kummer has thoughts, but we want yours too on your favorite or most horrifying moments at the legendary Cheesecake Factory. All that ahead, Boston Public Radio, 89.7 GBH.
Live from NPR News in Washington, I'm Lakshmi Singh. As the new Congress convenes, Republicans are taking control of the U.S. House. But GOP leader Kevin McCarthy's quest to ascend to House Speaker is scrambling to secure a simple majority of votes. Moments ago, he publicly called out the small group of conservative Republicans blocking him.
I don't see how a few people, maybe it's 5, maybe it's 20, sit because they want a gavel that they can't earn by the conference of themselves. That would be interesting to me.
NPR's Deirdre Walsh has more.
McCarthy was nominated by House Republicans in November after the GOP won a narrow 4-seat majority in the 2022 midterms. But he still has to win a majority of the full House in order to be elected Speaker. A block of his critics say they want to change how the House operates, and McCarthy isn't the leader to make that happen. If he fails to secure 218 votes, or a majority of those present and voting, the vote for Speaker could take multiple ballots. No other House business can happen until a Speaker is chosen, and members can't be sworn in to start the new session. Deirdre Walsh, NPR News.
Buffalo Bills safety DeMar Hamlin is in critical condition after he collapsed during last night's game against the Cincinnati Bengals. He'd suffered a cardiac arrest. Hamlin was transferred to University of Cincinnati Medical Center. Dr. Christopher Medeas, director of the New England Cardiac Arrhythmia Center at Tufts Medical Center, offers more insight into Hamlin's condition.
I'm speculating, but this looked to be what's called commotio cordis, which is a blunt chest blow to the chest that can induce dangerous, life-threatening heart rhythm or cardiac arrest. And this is a rare event that occurs most commonly in the setting of sport. Most commonly in sports that involve blunt projectiles that impact the chest wall, such as baseball, hockey, lacrosse. It's rare in football.
Dr. Medea speaking with NPR's Morning Edition. Israel's new foreign minister has spoken with Russia's foreign minister, Sergei Lavrov. NPR's Daniel Estrin has the latest.
Till now, Israel has not given Ukraine weapons in order to preserve its security and diplomatic ties with Russia. But Israel's previous government did accuse Russia of war crimes. Now, Israel is led again by Benjamin Netanyahu, who before the war worked closely with Russian President Vladimir Putin. The Israeli foreign ministry says new minister Eli Cohen spoke with his Russian counterpart about bilateral and regional issues and Russia's Jewish community. Foreign Minister Cohen said in a speech that Israel will, quote, speak less in public about the war in Ukraine. U.S. Republican Senator Lindsey Graham called that unnerving and said Israel's foreign minister should know Lavrov represents, quote, a war criminal regime. Daniel Estrin, NPR News, Tel Aviv.
This is NPR.
Good afternoon. With the latest from the GBH newsroom, I'm Henry Santoro in Brookline this wet Tuesday. Massachusetts Congresswoman Catherine Clark becomes House Minority Whip this afternoon as the 118th Congress convenes, making her the second ranking Democrat in the House. She's only the second woman to hold that position.
We are excited for the session ahead. We have a historically diverse new members coming in, more women, LGBTQ, people of color than ever before.
New York Congressman Hakeem Jeffries will serve as the next House Minority Leader, also making history as the first Black Party leader in Congress, and Congressman Pete Aguilar will take on the highest job ever held by a Latino in Congress as chair of the House Democratic Caucus. I'll get it. The parent company of a marijuana cultivation facility in Holyoke has agreed to pay a $14,000 settlement to the U.S. Department of Labor's Occupational Safety and Health Administration, or OSHA. The money is part of a settlement agreed on by Florida-based Trulieve after 27-year-old Lorna McCurry died from an inability to breathe after inhaling cannabis dust at the Holyoke facility last year. In addition to the fine, Trulieve will perform a study to determine whether ground cannabis dust should be classified as a hazardous chemical in an occupational setting, according to OSHA's regulations. In the forecast, more rain for the next few days. Temps in the 40s each day. Right now, 42 degrees. I'm Henry Santoro, GBH News, 89.7.
Support for NPR comes from NPR stations. Other contributors include Noom, a personalized weight loss program based in psychology for helping people change their habits and conquer their goals. Learn more at Noom, NOOM.com, and the listeners who support this NPR station.
Jim Brady, I am Marjorie Egan. You're listening to Boston Public Radio, 89.7 GBH. We are broadcasting live as we do every Tuesday and every Friday from the Boston Public Library, where, by the way, you don't need any tickets. People often say
you don't
need tickets. No, you don't need tickets. You just show up and stay as long as you want or as little as you want. We are also streaming on youtube.com/GBH.
They don't need tickets?
They don't need tickets.
That's
no.
Unbelievable. It's free?
And it's free.
It's free.
It's free. That's right. Plus, there's a news
sort of cheapens our whole operation,
it does.
Doesn't
well,
it?
Well, you know, we can't
get
ask
for nothing.
Can't ask for too much, Jim.
In any case,
you need to park the car.
Before I introduce our next guest, can I give you two updates on what much of America is focused on? Is Kevin McCarthy becoming speaker or not? Here's Matt Gaetz. He's the congressman from Florida who, in my opinion, should have been indicted for trafficking an underage girls, but he wasn't. Here he is talking to reporters earlier today about his position on McCarthy as potential Speaker of the House.
Those of us who will not be voting for Kevin McCarthy today take no joy in this discomfort that this moment has brought. But if you want to drain the swamp, you cannot put the biggest alligator in charge of the exercise. I'm a Florida man, and I know of what I speak.
So he's one of five who allegedly are hardcore never for McCarthy, so McCarthy may not make it. We shall see. The second update is thanks to our friend, satirist Andy Borowitz. Here's his headline, Marjorie and Juliet. Carrie Lake furious that some liars, like George Santos, got to win, and she did not. In any case, joining us now is Juliet Kayyem. Juliet is the former Assistant Secretary for Homeland Security under Barack Obama, faculty chair of the Homeland Security Program at Harvard's Kennedy School of Government. Her latest book is The Devil Never Sleeps, Learning to Live in an Age of Disasters. Happy New Year, and hello, Juliet Kayyem.
Happy New Year to
hey
both
there.
Of you.
Oh,
hello,
applause.
Juliet.
Oh,
wow.
Absolutely. God, it's all downhill from here, people.
I would say that's probably
true. I know, but
true.
Thank you for coming out on this gloomy day.
Remember the glory moments when you can.
It's free. It's free. If we made them pay, there'd be no one here. I'm not. There's no delusions
that
here.
That is really unkind.
I'm sorry.
Let me tell you.
I'm sorry.
Would any of you pay? Raise your hands if we charge you to get here.
Liars, all of you.
That's not
true. Liars, all of you.
Maybe a thank you for trying to.
Yeah. Okay. Well, a little collection at the door.
I know.
So Juliet Kayyem.
They all said, "Do you think he really believed that?" The answer is no. I didn't believe it. Don't worry about it.
In one of the most hard to understand and brutal murders, time, these four young, early 21-year-olds and two 20-year-olds killed at the University of Iowa, stabbed to death in their beds. Mm-hmm. We now have a 28-year-old criminology student charged with the quadruple murders?
Yes, four of them. Three girls and a guy.
Yeah. What do you make of this guy?
We don't know yet. We'll know a lot more. I think it's today or as
the
late.
The extradition hearing,
yeah, the extradition hearing is today. The Idaho law is unique in that they can't file essentially an affidavit describing what they know about him until he's in state. I don't, that's some legacy rule. He's in Pennsylvania. He's now being shipped over. He's waived any challenge to extradition, so he'll show up in Idaho. Then we'll be able to file. And I think the big question, they'll be able to file. The big question everyone's waiting for is, as we know how the murders occurred, is why. And the why is, I guess there's two whys, right? One is just, he's clearly a sociopath, but like, was he planning this through his studies? Because there's these Reddit posts and others where he's like trying to learn from people who have committed crimes
interview
and violent crimes.
They about interview their them. Emotions,
right?
And
how
thoughts.
Did you feel?
Yeah.
But the second, which I think is why this case has been so hard to watch, I think, for any parent who has kids off in college and these college communities that are intimate and doors are open and people are partying and everyone is just having, you know, doesn't worry about things like this, is why that house? And did he have a relationship or did he think he had a relationship with any of the girls, either online or did one of them snub him or something like that? So that's sort of what they're waiting for to find out. In some ways, I hate saying this, like, I hope so, you know, in some weird way, because you just think, like, you know, this is, you know, just...
You don't want it to be random, because it's scary.
You don't want it to be random. And I think the other thing that is so startling to people is that he stabbed to death four people.
Yeah.
He didn't shoot them.
No, it's
so
an
you
intimacy,
wonder,
yeah.
And that they were sleeping at the time. Two other roommates were
are
there.
Downstairs.
Slept through the whole thing. But it's amazing to me that no one heard anybody cry out.
Yeah.
You know, it's just...
he might have muffled them or whatever.
You don't know.
Or, yeah.
It's a very hard to understand crime.
Yeah, yeah. And that the two girls are downstairs or upstairs or wherever the physical aspects of it are. You know, it's so horrifying. They wake up late, as college students often do, 11 a.m. They can't get into one of the rooms. They think one of the girls has passed out because they haven't heard anything. Yeah. And then they call and realize what has happened in the entire house.
I have a couple of questions for you about this. One, the police chief, after he announced the arrest of this guy, police chief in Moscow, Idaho, says, stay vigilant.
Yes.
Which made me think he thinks maybe he isn't the only person. That's one.
Yeah.
Two, in another example of me speaking out passionately about something about which I know nothing, I have been among those who criticized the performance of the police there for total nothing burger
right.
for 7 weeks. In retrospect, it looks like they may have actually known what they were doing.
Yes, and I think, you know, given that, you know, we're sort of coming out of Uvalde, where you think about these small police, these small community police departments, and they don't know what they're doing. I would say it's fair to have criticized them in that first 24, 48 hours when they didn't know what they had, and they really were not that transparent about what had happened, and maybe they thought, you know, it's a small community, so they don't know, you know, is it one of them? I mean, mm-hmm. they don't even know if it's a police officer or someone else. But once they sort of had a sense of what was going on, it's totally legitimate to shut down in that sense. We don't know when they were able to find out about the additional fingerprints and then the match. It's clear that
The DNA match.
It's clear when police departments say anything that you may have will be helpful is true, because it was the car identification that came from
Hyundai.
A woman's Nest camera or something like that actually got them the identification. That's when they could do the DNA match. I don't know how they got his DNA.
The FBI and the state
officials.
And
they were clearly being cooperative.
Weren't there like four or five? I mean, this was a
teeny, between the local, sheriff, state,
police department,
and federal.
But how about the stay vigilant thing? Am I making too much out of this?
Well, I think if you're a university president, you're going to say
that. No, this is like ahead of the cops.
And the cops. There's some rumors, and they've been reported on that when he was arrested, he said, did you arrest anyone else? And so the question is, was there someone else? I don't think there's any proof of that. And if he's as good in the bad, evil way that we think, he studied ways to manipulate narratives. So when he knows that's going to come out, everyone's looking for a second person. There's probably not a second person. That's probably just him.
And we should point out, you mentioned he was a sociopath. These stories about him say that his intense demeanor made people very unsettled. That
in
he
your
seemed
face.
To be more animated after the killing. He made remarks about LGBTQ people. And he made so many offensive remarks that people did not want to be friends with him. So there was clearly an issue here.
Right. And we don't know how long that had been going on. Was there some triggering event? But of course, we're all sort of waiting for the why this house.
Yeah.
Why this house? And, you know, these guys, you know, maybe they were on a dating website and she said something mean to him.
Exactly.
Not even mean, but just I'm not interested. And that's enough to trigger someone.
Can we spend about a minute on another act of violence? The machete wielding guy outside Times Square. I have to say I've told Margie this. One of the most terrifying nights of my life is I decided I had to do when I was in law school, New York Times Square one night on New Year's Eve. And I don't know if anyone's ever been packed in like a sardine at any event. But you basically feel if one person falls down, we're all going to be dead.
Right.
I mean, that is the feeling.
South Korea,
it's that tight.
Yeah.
But I guess the question is, I know the question is for me, as good a job as New York City cops do at things like that, and I've seen it firsthand and I read a lot about this thing here, is there any way to keep a thing like this safe? There's not, isn't there?
No. I mean,
you just keep it safer than
safer,
unsafe.
That's your whole deal, right?
Yeah,
there's no safe, there's only safer. Let me just say the good news in this sense. He did not get into one of the secure pens. So the way that they've designed New Year's Eve after 9/11, COVID, all sorts of different changes have been going on. And then, of course, crowd control, what you're describing, which was probably the most likely thing, is they have these ways in which people enter. The Boston Marathon does this now too, so you don't get crowd crushed. You have to enter through
checkpoints
essentially. And the closer you want to get, the more rigorous the checkpoints get. And so he doesn't get into one of these secure areas, which would have been a nightmare because that's where the crowding occurs. He's been radicalized relatively recently. He's not Muslim, though he claims to be an adherent, and I'm being careful. These are his claims of Islam and to have been radicalized by jihadism and the Taliban. We don't know if that's true. We don't know if there's connections. These guys always leave documents, diaries. That's what he did, saying what he believes. His mother, and this is not easy to do, but God bless her in some way, she had come forward.
Totally,
that is so hard to do and say, my son, my son is lost, and had told the police they had interviewed him. The challenge is, of course, if he comes off as normal, but just a little bit odd, you can't arrest him. And then he just, this guy went from 0 to 60, and there's no prior criminal activity. So it's really hard to catch people like this. But of course, a terror attack averted is a success. I mean, that's just the way we have to see, have to view it.
You know, it's a real dilemma because you cannot force someone to get treatment if they don't want it. But I think for parents who know that their child is off the deep end and they're really afraid of that child, you see this over and over again. Yeah. There's nothing they can do.
Right.
Well, there are some things you have to go through the courts.
But I have
that's
say,
very
I
difficult.
Would much prefer a world in which parents are engaging public officials in what's happening with their children, that they can't recapture them, than the world that we actually live in, which is a lot of parents knowing something is wrong with their child. Look at all these school shootings.
In some of these cases,
it's just neglect. These parents are just sort of unwilling to admit what they don't want to admit, that their child is playing with guns and sort of fascinated with school shootings. In at least two cases so far, in terms of state criminal charges, the parents are now being gone after, because if you know what your child is saying, you would admit, you help them get a weapon that's going to kill lots of people. And what are you thinking? I mean, you're just going to enable them? Like, it's just, you can't enable a mass killer, in particular if you're the parent. So
I'd
much rather have the world in which...
But I think the problem for a lot of parents is the idea of calling the cops on your own kid, having your kid taken out in handcuffs and go to the court, is like a step...
Well, how about, states that have red flag laws like Massachusetts does, that's a middle step. You're not having your kid incarcerated.
That is a very good step.
Take away his or her weapons.
Most states have something in between you're in jail and the kid gets to go do a mass shooting. I mean, there are systems that can work for parents. And the bigger problem is the parents that don't come forward.
Can we talk about systems that don't work for a second?
Oh,
NPR,
yes.
In a report on Southwest Airlines, I think this was an unintended pun. In the middle of their report, listing what went wrong, they say, Southwest is not a fly-by-night operation. I would argue that would be wrong.
Who did that? Who said that?
I don't know. Whoever it was,
so funny.
I don't think. That was Camila Domanowski.
We love her. Yeah. We love her.
So could you explain in English, and you did a pretty good job wherever you did it.
Thank you.
This point-to-point versus hub and spoke, whatever the
this
hell.
This is like a dream come true.
For you, that, you that, mean.
It's like security aviation complex systems. Okay, let's just, every other airline lives by the hub and spoke process, which is you have one hub or multiple hubs. Just I'm doing hand gestures now, everyone. So you
really
you have different
radio,
spokes
yeah.
That go to different cities. So let's say you have Atlanta. Atlanta goes to Chicago. If something happens in Chicago, you either or is about to happen, you get the planes out of Chicago so that they aren't in Atlanta, and then you're able to satisfy the travel needs through other means. You're not, you don't have a single point of failure, which is if Chicago goes down, the whole system goes down. And you can close hubs, and you go, they just have figured this out. Southwest, for a variety of reasons, including its low cost, is because it doesn't maintain extra capacity in these hubs, has what's called the point-to-point system. So you have airplane A is going from Denver, Chicago, New York, Florida, back to Denver. Chicago shuts down. The three later cities are now screwed, are now high. Hi, public radio.
No,
are
screwed
not,
is fine.
Screwed
I
is
mean,
okay.
Screwed,
screwed,
yeah.
Yeah, they're screwed. Absolutely screwed. And so this is what Southwest has lived by. They've known it's an antiquated system. It might have been okay when it was a local and or regional airline. What happened is it started to grow. It's now the fourth largest domestic airline and didn't change its system. It has known, it also is thriving off of really bad technology. So there's gonna be, and so that has also been known in the sense of, do you know where your pilots are? Do you know what your customer, are you telling things to your customer? The one thing that I noted in sort of examining this is they did not have any clear sense, or at least they didn't acknowledge it, of what was happening to the system as it was falling apart. When you know it's falling apart, you keep everyone out of the airports. So people aren't being told, simply do not come to the airport, right? They're given these stupid emails about, we're not sure, blah, blah, blah. Do not come to the airport, because it was at the airport where you're just seeing these horrible stories where people are either stuck or they don't know what to do and stuff. So it's fixable. There's going to be hearings and everyone's going to think, change the CEO and stuff. It's not. This is, I like fixable problems. This is fixable, and everyone's grandstanding. My solution is, you want to fly in the friendly skies, make them friendlier, and you're going to have to, over the next 2 or 3 years, transition to a system that aligns with your size now in the U.S.
So let's talk about how Southwest really has gotten the message from Juliette Guyon. In the same NPR story, they mentioned
story.
A FAQ, frequently asked questions, yeah. on Southwest travel disruption site. So, Marjorie, do you have that in front of you?
I don't think I do.
Yes, you do.
FAQs.
Okay. You don't have it? Okay, then I'll read both the question and the answer.
Okay.
What should you do if receiving an error message while attempting to rebook online? Now, the revamped Southwest, what do you think they said? We encourage you to keep trying.
Okay.
That's helpful.
What
should
one?
You do if you can't find any seats on flights? We encourage you to keep looking. And what if you are stuck for on hold? This is like an SNL routine. What if you are stuck on hold for hours and can't get through to an agent? If you need to reach us urgently, you may continue to call.
To do so, yeah.
So, and there you go. That solves the problems pretty well.
I think, by the way,
let me tell you my analysis, and I have no expertise like you do. When we used to have people like, well, Deval Patrick, Charlie Baker, soon more Healy on monthly with us, I would always say the reason people in the legislature and some governors don't fix a long-term problem is because you're, we had this discussion with you and Baker in your book, is that you're convinced, you're hoping the bridge doesn't fall down on your watch. You know it's going to fall down eventually, but not now. I think the same thing here. When the IT system is from the 90s, when the point-to-point thing is obviously going to break at some point, a CEO has got to be saying, I'm just going to hope I'm gone
and
when it falls apart, right?
And you can no longer say that these weather events are a surprise. That was my point
in the
piece.
Oh, that's a great point, of course.
Like, if I hear another CEO say, well, it's like, you know, historic snow. It's like they're historic every month
that's
now.
Hard.
Like, I don't know
they're
what
once in a century every month.
Once in a century since last month. Like, it's just ridiculous. And so, you know, they're not, no one is adapting. But look, this is aviation is one of the most regulated industries in the country, let alone internationally. We have international standards as well. This is not an unregulated industry where you're trying to get the government involved. And so there are conditions that for the benefit of flight that Southwest can be pushed to. It's just a question of whether the transportation secretary will do it. I mean, I know people are angry.
Secretary is Pete Buttigieg.
Sorry. But let's just stop with the grandstanding, and they're so horrible, and just require them to fix it because they're not fixing it themselves.
Okay, let's move on to our favorite congressperson to be. That would be George Santos, of course, you may recall. Person that lied about where he went to high school, lied about where he went to college.
Is that his name?
No, it's not. It's Anthony DeVoldo.
Yeah. Oh, Anthony DeVoldo. That's right. It lied about his name. It add that to it. Lied about being Jewish. Lied about being the son of parents who escaped the Holocaust. Lied about rescuing thousands of cats and dogs. Goes on. He lied about his entire life,
basically.
Can
I just say something weird about his lie? I mean, his lies are weird across the board. There's a weird fascination. We see this in all sorts of tragedies, in particular terrorism ones, in which people want to be a part of it, and so like they show up and pretend like they're first responders. And there's ways in which we deal with stuff like this because you're always anticipating the sort of people who want to be. He has a very perverse desire to be affiliated with these,
Goldman
historic.
Sachs. Yeah, oh, no, oh, what
like
do you mean?
9/11, the Holocaust.
Oh, yeah, said his mother died on 9/11.
But then the one I thought was weird was Pulse. He says that he lost five friends or employees at the
Pulse.
That's just someone who's like a
bizarre.
People get
a zealot kind of thing.
Yeah, they get their. Jolly.
Wait a second, how about his mother dying on 9/11 when she didn't die until 2016?
Yeah, that's right. She didn't die in 2016.
Sort of the same category.
Yeah. Anyway, now he not only has the federal and local prosecutors looking into potential criminal activity involving his campaigns. Apparently, Brazil now is reviving this fraud charges against him, and they're looking for a response from Mr. Santos.
So they've been looking.
Who's about to be?
He may be already. We don't know.
He may be already.
Unbelievable. This is the thing about the Republicans. They deserve what's happening with McCarthy. They deserve everything because the idea that George Santos is going away and that there's not worse about him. This was the Trump phenomenon, which I would just placate him for a couple weeks and everything will be fine. They get worse, right? And so the idea that they can't even get enough people to say he should not sit. I don't know how it works exactly, but it's basically the party's
two-thirds.
They knew they didn't have the votes. It's just ridiculous.
Well, if McCarthy said, I want you to do this, assuming he became speaker, obviously the old Democrats would vote to expel him, so he'd be expelled. Yeah.
They choose not to.
Voting for McCarthy.
Right. And it is remarkable. He's not going away. But yes, this would be hilarious. The Justice Department agrees. I think we have an extradition treaty.
Send him back to Brazil.
But he had some charges from Brazil related to, I think, financial
fraud. A stolen checkbook.
Yeah. This guy is a piece of work. And so that proceeding, because we have formal extradition, basically Brazil has formally asked the United States for oversight of him. In other words, they want to bring charges against him. The U.S. Department of Justice is going to have to make a formal decision. You don't get to just ignore Brazil. We are going to have to make a decision about whether he would be subject to Brazil's
cause of action. Yeah, but my understanding, and you're a lawyer, so maybe you know the answer to this. My understanding is his lawyers have agreed that while George Santos is not willing to be extradited, Anthony DeVoldo is willing to be extradited.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
That should solve the problem.
Exactly.
Don't you think?
Exactly. It is. What a mess. It is so bizarre, I have to say.
It is.
Yeah. He's tried to steal. He did steal $700 worth of clothes.
I think the Pulse thing was just.
Oh, that's right. Well, the mother thing is pretty.
The
bad
mother
too.
Thing is just weird, but like the Pulse thing, like it's not like people don't think about Pulse all the time. It's like someone
he wants
who's
to
like
be sort of, part of everything.
Yeah, he wants to be part of everything.
He says he's gay. We don't know if he's gay. He may be gay. He was married to a woman for a while, so
he's married
bisexual.
To a man.
And hid the fact that he was married.
Yeah.
To a woman.
Yeah. So I mean, the whole thing is sort of.
Okay.
He wouldn't be a guy you'd want to go.
You know what I think? You know what I think?
No, I don't.
I think we should make him a congressman.
I think you should.
I think that is
why
the
not?
Solution to fine. What ails America is turn him into a...
Okay.
Julie,
thank you, Julia.
Wait. Making laws for the rest of us
is the McCarthy we do love.
Oh, yes, there she
right.
is.
Right, the McCarthy. Other McCarthy, yay.
We were both in the Obama administration.
Many years ago and at the Kennedy School, but she's back. But anyways, I was thinking, I kept hearing you say McCarthy, and I was like, they're talking about Gina a lot.
That's right.
So, yes, because the other McCarthy.
Well, you know, actually, the headline on CNN was, pivotal moment for McCarthy.
That's right.
And they meant Gina McCarthy.
It's I know.
To be on
I
Boston
hope she's
Public
ready.
Radio.
Yeah, exactly. Okay.
We shall see.
Okay, pay
good
up, everyone. Pay up.
Thank you, Juliette Kayyem. Juliette is the former Assistant Secretary for Homeland Security under President Barack Obama, the faculty chair of the Homeland Security Program at Harvard's Kennedy School of Government. Her latest book, The Devil Never Sleeps, Learning to Live in the Age of Disasters. Okay, coming up, as we just said, she was the country's first ever presidential climate advisor serving in the Biden administration until September of last year. Gina McCarthy is here to talk climate goals. You're listening to Boston Public Radio, 89.7 GBH. We are broadcasting live from the Boston Public Library, as we do every Tuesday and every Friday. We're streaming live on youtube.com/GBH News.
From the GBH Newsroom.
I'm Pam Johnston, General Manager of Local News at GBH. Audience-first journalism is about listening. We're telling stories about and with our community in ways that involve our community. If done well and done right, it is a feedback loop. We really are looking at like building a relationship and telling stories that matter to people with them, not about them.
Part of your community. GBH 89.7.
Support for our programs comes from you and the Office of the Massachusetts State Treasurer. The Unclaimed Property Division is holding unclaimed funds for the citizens and businesses of the Commonwealth. You can see if you have unclaimed money at findmassmoney.com. And National Grid, providing access to electric heat pumps, which offer heating and cooling for businesses of all sizes to help them achieve their sustainability goals. You can learn more about heat pump technology at ngrid.com/future.
Welcome back to Boston Public Radio. Jim Browdy, Marjorie Egan, live from the Boston Public Library, streaming at youtube.com/GBH News. We're now really excited to be joined by Gina McCarthy. Until September of last year, Gina was the first ever White House National Climate Advisor serving President Biden. She left immediately after the largest climate protection measure in the history of this country was signed into law. Previously, she ran the Environmental Protection Agency in the Obama administration. Before that, she was commissioner, of the Connecticut Department of Environmental Protection, served five Massachusetts Democratic and Republican administrations. She's doing it again, now assisting incoming governor-elect Maura Healey, serving as co-chair of Healey's Climate Change Transition Policy Committee. Gina McCarthy, it is great to see you. Thanks so much for being here.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for coming in. I want to start with some good news, because we get so depressed, at least I do, about the climate situation. You know, President Biden, you were there for this massive piece of climate legislation. So let's highlight what has been done that's going to matter.
Oh, man, there's so much that's gotten done, and I hate it when you read my bio like that. I'm only 35. I've just been incredibly productive. What he did was to really change the entire paradigm around climate change. Instead of talking about what we had to give up, it was all about what we had to gain.
Yeah.
So he really transformed our thinking about climate as one that would benefit people, one that would grow our economy, one that would help address some of the inequities in our country, and shift this to an investment framing. And it made all the difference in the world. You know, people found that hard to dispute because climate change is real. It's going to change everything. If we can capture this as an economic opportunity, a job growth opportunity, a way to advance public health, a way to really advance equity in a very strong and dynamic way. And then he delivered really big pieces of legislation that would support that kind of dynamic change. We're talking about the bipartisan infrastructure law. That's $1.2 trillion,
yep.
Not just in infrastructure, but in infrastructure that matters to people. It wasn't just about building buildings better and more resilient or more efficient. It was also about our water and our sewer systems. It's how do you deal with these issues that we know we've neglected for so long in so many parts of the country that are fundamental benefits that I think we don't really worry that much about, but many should. And so it was remarkable. And then you had the Inflation Reduction Act, which was pregnant for longer than I have ever been, that's for sure. Well, not if you count it all up, I guess. But it was, you know, it took a long time to deliver. But that piece of congressional action was the most significant to actually address climate than everything else that's ever been done before. It's $370 billion, but it's an enticement. It changes things. It sent this huge signal to the private sector about what we value, about what we're going to do. And they've been investing like crazy ever since.
I want to talk to you about the private sector in a minute, but what's the worst thing you ever heard Joe Biden say about Manchin? Okay, that was got us
that was
nowhere.
It. Yep.
Okay,
yep, that was
fine.
It. You wrote, actually, the answer to that is nothing.
Is that really true?
Yeah. We did, you know, the question wasn't about how bad Manchin was. That's not the issue. The issue was how do you do what Joe Biden always does, which is to find the ground that works, to actually move it forward. So I had never heard a disparaging word from
really
Joe Biden. Yeah, because he was, you know, I've known Senator Biden, Senator Manchin for a long time, Senator Biden as well. And, you know, he had his own opinion about things and he had leverage to hold it up. But in the end, he did the right thing.
You know, Gina McCarthy, I read the piece you wrote, sort of your exit interview with yourself in the New York Times, talking, and you said a lot of what you said to Marjorie a minute ago, which is, I'm putting words in your mouth, but you'll correct them if I'm overstating it, that one of the things you feel good about, in addition to obviously what happened on your watch with you and the president, is how business finally gets it, that it's not just a good and moral thing to do, but it's a good economic and jobs kind of thing to do. Bill McKibben is with us every month.
Yep.
He's not nearly as optimistic about the business community as you are. So is that putting a hope ahead of reality, or do you really think there's concrete evidence that the business community in this country gets it?
Well, I'm not sure that any big change doesn't require hope to come before the goodies, right? You've got to, you know, give people a sense that change can happen. And then you've got to be really smart about pushing it. And so, I mean, Bill's been a good friend for years. And he has a framing that's different than how President Biden has framed it and myself. But they sort of join hands in the middle. You know, you have to keep pushing business forward and actually hold them accountable.
What are some give us an example or two of something you find most hopeful that's not aberrational in the big business community on the climate front?
Well, you know, some of the things that I'm working on now is to look at how we advance international investments, especially in the global south, or in some of these small island nations that are struggling. The thing that I'm seeing now is I know there's a lot of investment opportunity, and I can see it being made to put solar arrays, but I don't want a solar array on one part of the island while the other part has the LNG terminal being constructed. And so I think what I'm trying to do is marry these with requiring or supporting, I should say, countries to do the kind of planning that the U.S. gets to do to figure out what their own destiny is. The Global South does not need, you know, projects. They need an economic development strategy just like we do. We have to have the Global South succeed, or internationally we won't. And so I am seeing the investment world starting to recognize that their obligation is not just to make money, but you're only going to consistently make money if you do it in concert with those governments, those cultures, their ability to be able to feel good about the benefits that are being accrued to them.
We're talking to Gina McCarthy, a local kid who was head of the EPA for Barack Obama, chief climate advisor to President Joe Biden.
You know, bringing it back to the United States here for a second, I think a lot of people, myself included, are very concerned about the Supreme Court, which seems to be very interested in making it harder and harder harder for the federal government to regulate all sorts of areas in the country. Obviously, they've made it harder for the EPA to regulate. They're maybe making it harder to have a clean water regulation, a Supreme Court case that's pending.
Yep.
So that's not looking good. I mean, if the EPA can't regulate pollution, you know, that's a problem.
I would agree with you, having worked there for 8 years.
Yeah.
You know, I do understand that there's been decisions made. One was on a piece of legislation that I shepherded at EPA on how we get sort of reductions of carbon pollution from the utilities. And it, you know, it's challenging. That could have been worse. It was a push, but it wasn't a shove. Uh-huh. It was
being the Supreme Court decision in June.
That's right.
Saying you can deal with individual power plants, not with the class of power plants.
Yes, but every decision is looked at by every lawyer in the world, and then you go and try to figure out if you have a path forward. There still is one there. Mm-hmm. And so you have to be clever. I know what the laws say. I understand the direction they want us to go in. And every time it limits it, it gets it more difficult. But it doesn't mean you can't use, you know, creativity and strategies to keep making progress moving forward. You know, the one thing that I've realized is when change starts happening, it gathers its own momentum.
Uh-huh.
It happens everywhere. You just have to keep pushing. And so at some point in time, you know, I think that we are going to clearly see the Supreme Court make decisions I don't like. Many of us don't. I clearly have seen it already. But it doesn't mean that you don't keep finding a path forward. Whether it's as successful as the one that they just blew out, maybe not, but you'll keep pushing.
And yet at the same time, the New York Times did a really upsetting story about what they called a toxic stew on Cape Cod, human waste and warming water. And they focused on Mashpee, where this person went out, was like up to her waist in gunk because the water there was so polluted and the mussels were dying and everything. It was described as gray-black goo that was polluting the Mashpee River. Then you've got the problem of the kettle ponds that are getting polluted. Then you've got the problems of the septic systems that are going into the water. This massive mess of pollution on Cape Cod, and they quote the guy from the guy in is it Yarmouth?
I think it was Yarmouth, the town manager.
Who said, you know, this is all too expensive. This is all too expensive. We can't have the sewage and we can't regulate what's going into the water. These things are too expensive. And you hear that still a lot. So, I mean, minds have to be changed, don't they? And money found?
Yeah, hopefully people are getting the realization that if they don't take action now, the costs are much more significant the longer you delay, right? I mean, everything tells you that. Every time somebody analyzes, it's pay me now or pay me a lot more later. You know, this situation down the Cape is not a new one. It's getting worse, but it's not a new one. Isn't it about time that they replace the old toxic cesspools with real systems that work? How can anybody that runs anywhere down the Cape think that people will want to swim or vacation or go down to the Cape if this is what they're facing every day? It's ridiculous. And it's not a surprise. It's just been going on and on. Okay. We've been eking forward to try to figure out ways to keep helping.
I don't want to get lost in the weeds, though, but you're doing the transition thing with Healy on the environment. She just picked, I think, the first ever cabinet-level climate person a week or so ago. You were pretty excited about it, so I assume you were involved in that. It seems to me when so many homeowners and officials on the Cape, staying there for a minute, are saying this is unaffordable, I can barely pay my mortgage, much less the cost of replacement, it sounds to me that's a place where a state has to step in and provide some support. Is that what Healy should be doing?
That's one of the reasons why the federal government has stepped up with the bipartisan infrastructure law. The parts I'm talking about infrastructure for things like water and wastewater, are going to the states. It's not, they're not holding it hostage. They're actually delivering it for the states.
So this should be. There's money there now.
This should be the time when those issues are resolved. And so I know that Governor-elect Healy is all over these issues. You know, we've been working really hard over the past, it feels like 10 years, but it's only been, I think, a month to get that sort of the next delving of her transition plan in place. And she's being inaugurated soon. I'm sure she'll have more to say. But I have, you know, done work with this woman. She is smart. She's focused. She's committed. And it's going to be fun to see what her administration looks like. But also, the thing that I really like best recently, and others may not feel the same, but she was a class act in the transition from a Republican administration to a Democratic administration.
That's true.
That should give us the model for everybody else to follow.
But Kevin McCarthy's listening. He agrees with you completely. Now, let me ask one more negative thing, because you're a relentlessly positive, which I love, because you actually know what you're talking about, as opposed to me on this issue. So I'm watching 60 Minutes the other night. Did you see 60 Minutes?
I did.
Okay. So can we agree, I think all three of us, let's establish ground rules, that human extinction is a bad thing. Do we agree with that?
Yes.
Okay. And animal extinction is a bad thing. Do we agree with that? Okay, fine. Here's Paul Ehrlich, who in 1968 wrote a book that sort of started this whole thing. He's talking to Scott Pelley, that saying the Earth is quickly running out of resources needed for survival. Here's Ehrlich and then Pelley.
Oh, humanity is not sustainable to maintain our lifestyle, yours and mine, basically, for the entire planet. You'd need five more Earths. Not clear where they're going to come from.
Just in terms of the resources that would be required.
Resources that would be required, the systems that support our lives, which of course are the biodiversity that we're wiping out. Humanity is very busily sitting on a limb that we're sawing off.
So how do you respond, Ehrlich?
I certainly wouldn't disagree with him. I think the question is, do we give up or do we keep pushing? And I
you
know
don't think
that
it's
there
too
was.
Late.
How do I know? I mean, things escalate quickly, and then you keep doing analysis, and you see you're beginning to win. I really don't know, Jim. But this is, I have four grandchildren now, and one on the way. I'm fighting for them, not whether I think it's a good idea or not. I'm going to go after every morsel of hope and opportunity that I can find in hopes that that is what makes that transition happen.
Well, one of the scariest things he said, Paul Ehrlich, when he was there, was he said, you know, the planet has survived five extinctions. He was predicting that we're about to have the sixth extinction, and the planet will survive the sixth extinction. We won't. And that was what was so upsetting. The planet will go on, but human beings...
Extinction is upsetting. I found that to be...
That's right.
I found that generally to be...
It's a dramatic word.
And he was talking about
sure.
not just climate. He was talking about overpopulation.
Yeah.
Saying that we reached our peak in 1970.
Hey, Gina McCarthy, I want to talk about you for a minute.
Okay.
I mean, you've been in some really important places and made some really important change. But I wonder how someone like you deals with frustration. Let me give you two examples. One, in this 60 Minutes piece... They go to Central or South America, and they talk to a guy who is leading an experiment, essentially, where there are direct payments made to people who'd be doing deforestation, and basically saying, we're going to pay you more than you'd make from doing that bad thing for the climate to not do that bad thing. And it was stunningly affordable. That's one thing. And the issue is, can you
replicate
it and bring it up?
At scale.
John Kerry was with me on television a couple of weeks ago after he came back from the COP. Is it 27? I think it was 27. And one of the major accomplishments, as you know, was an agreement by the wealthier developed countries to compensate some of the places you were talking about before that are literally and figuratively going under. And one of the things I said to Secretary Kerry was the same commitment was made years ago and nobody anteed up to get there. When you know that there are solutions, even if imperfect, that are achievable if people were honest and I don't even want to say courageous because I don't think it requires that much courage to do the right thing, how hard is it to deal with when they don't do those things that are right in front of their face? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, and I think, you know, I am hopeful, but I think maybe my biggest quality, or my husband might think, my biggest defect, is I'm incredibly stubborn. You know, I'm an old Irish woman from Boston. If you think that you can keep me down, you're wrong. And I don't know what elevates people and gives them a reason to work together and with one another if we don't do exactly what that person is doing,
so
which is prove things, escalate it. And I will not give up. And I actually am not sure that Paul Ehrlich was talking about people won't survive. The world as we know it won't.
Yeah.
And I want this world.
He's focusing on the biodiversity kinds of issues.
I want this world.
Yeah.
You know, this is kind of a small thing, but it's not that small. Somebody texted this a while ago, and I've thought about it before. Should kids be running around on artificial turf with PFAS, those forever chemicals, and the environmental questions about artificial turf? Shouldn't we be going back to the grass? I suppose you could put pesticides over the grass, too. But
well, you could try not to. There's certainly ways of doing that. You know, I sort of cringe every time I watch TV and I see a soccer player slide and all those little black pellets come up like a little smoke. That cannot be good.
No.
You know, and we've seen plenty of data and lots of concern about it. And so I do think people in communities that tend to be able to afford the fancier surfaces should
kids.
Probably think twice. Because that may be one more thing, Marjorie, about pay me now or pay me a lot more later.
Exactly.
So let me pursue one more negative route, if I may, which means you'll never come back, but I can't get out of my system. You were an advisor to Romney when he was here. And I would argue Romney was a little bit different here than he became when he moved to Utah, other than on impeachment things where he did really honorable, or conviction votes where he was really honorable and courageous. When you deal with, and I know you dealt with, you mentioned you had a long relationship with Manchin. I know he's a Democrat, but a very conservative Democrat. I know you've dealt with the Republicans along the way. Do they believe that this is a hoax like Donald Trump or the former Senate chair? Was it who was the Oklahoma chair?
Inhofe.
Yeah. Who said it was? Do they believe this, or is it a convenient truth to assuage their contributors? Because a lot of these people aren't dopes. A lot of them are pretty smart characters. What do they believe?
I think one of the biggest challenges that we have is the money in the system from the fossil fuel companies. So I don't know it's who they're trying to prove or who they're working for, you know? And no, I don't think any of them are in a fantasy world thinking that the climate isn't happening.
So is there a view?
But people are, though, not necessarily in a fantasy world, but, you know, when former President Trump got up in some speech he gave a while back and said, maybe it was...
A couple of months ago.
And said, in 300 years, the ocean is going to move up an eighth of an inch or something like that. I'm paraphrasing. There are people that do... This is a political thing, right?
Well, I mean... Much the same people that might be listening to ex-President Trump.
Right.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I can't, but all I know is that most people understand that the climate is changing. Most people would like to see actions being taken, but everybody is going to be protective of their own personal interests, right? And it's the fossil fuel companies that blocked, you know, efforts at the Egypt COP. To actually expand beyond phasing out coal to phasing out fossil fuels in general. That's Saudi Arabia and China. So everybody is looking at this from their own distinct interest. But let me say one more thing. And this is hopeful, so forgive me. There's a couple of things. One is, if you look, a lot of people worried about obviously the midterm election. I was pleased with the results, which it wish it went even better. But I think a lot of that, you did not hear about the climate being the story.
You did not
hear about the IRA, because they know that the Inflation Reduction Act and the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law is something their constituents want. We have to get constituents to keep demanding this. And the last thing I would say is that we had this whole plan to do EV infrastructure, right? The electric vehicle infrastructure. And we put out this plan with lots of criteria on what states need to do to get allocated the money. And we talked among ourselves about how many are we going to get, right? Because you figure, I won't get it from this one or this one. And when they came in, 50 of them came in. 50. hitting every single point they were required to do. They didn't advertise it. They won't talk about it. Many will make fun of electric vehicles, but who the hell's producing them? We are in key states. Who needs them? Their constituents. So while there may be all kinds of grumbling and mumbling and craziness going on the surface, below, the people that vote them in are the people that we have to speak to. I am going to ignore that nonsense and go after the people because they have to make democracy work.
Wow. So on that upbeat note, give us 30 seconds, Gina McCarthy. What are you doing in your post-Biden days? What's on your plate?
The vast majority of my time is being spent playing with my grandchildren, which I'm
good
very happy
you.
About. But beyond that, I'm going to do some and started some consulting work with a couple of large investment companies that I really feel have, you know, the right thinking. They want to do work, and they want to do work that's consistent with how to benefit some of these smaller countries and certainly in Africa, which I'm very interested in doing. And so I'm trying to do a lot of international work, and as we talked about, I'm doing a little domestic work with Mike Bloomberg and his team. I've been doing it for a long time, and there's a lot of work that I think we can do together, and so I'll keep my hand in and do what I can, and I'm excited about those opportunities. They're very different than stuff I've been doing before, and we'll see whether I can figure out all these spreadsheets. God.
Well, let me just say before you go, you have a lot, I know you know this, but won't say, you have a lot to be proud of from your work in government. You achieved great things, and we thank you for it. And we hope we see you again. Gina McCarthy, yes, thanks
so much
for your time.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thanks.
Gina McCarthy served as the first ever White House National Climate Advisor, serving President Biden, the EPA Administrator under President Obama, and she is co-chair of Governor-elect Healey's Climate Change Transition Policy Committee. Thank you again for coming in, Gina McCarthy.
Thanks.
Up next, how long can former President Trump outrun the law? It's time for another On the Docket with retired federal judge Nancy Gertner from Harvard Law School. You're listening to Boston Public Radio, 89.7 GBH. We are broadcasting live from the Boston Public Library, and we are streaming on youtube.com/GBH News. Nancy Gertner up next.
I'm Arun Roth. Coming up on GBH's All Things Considered, Governor Charlie Baker is giving a farewell address as he gets ready to leave office. The resignation of MBTA General Manager Steve Poftak is taking effect, and local schools are masking up amid new COVID fears. Those stories and all the day's news starting at 4 on GBH's All Things Considered.
Support for GBH comes from you. And Clover Food Lab, from Salad Monday to Taco Tuesday to Pizza Friday. Customers can choose a Clover meal box filled with seasonal vegetables for their family. You can find weekly recipes and learn more at cloverfoodlab.com. And Sunbug Solar, a full-service local solar energy company helping to grow renewable energy in Massachusetts since 2009. To learn more about current solar energy employment opportunities, visit sunbugsolar.com.
Trusted. Local. News. You're listening to 89.7 WGBH, HD1 Boston, online at gbhnews.org. GBH News with NPR. What matters to you.
Welcome back to Boston Public Radio. Mark Regan, Jim Browdy, live from the Boston Public Library, streaming on youtube.com/GBH News. By the way, the vote for Speaker is going on as we speak. We'll bring you the results, as tell you whether McCarthy has enough votes to become the next Speaker on the Republican side as soon as the votes are tallied. So here to tell us whether he will be or won't be indicted, that is, and other things, on another edition of On the Docket is Nancy Gertner. She's a retired federal judge, senior lecturer at Harvard Law School, and a BPR regular. Judge Gertner, before you answer the first question from Marjorie, you walked in, Marjorie's papers were splayed out all over the floor, and what was your comment, please?
That it looked like Mar-a-Lago.
Exactly.
That's right. I'm following in the footsteps of the former
really?
President.
Really? I could take a picture of it.
It's my slush. My slush pile.
That's classified.
Classified documents over there.
Yeah, actually.
That's right.
I'm good to see you, Judge.
I'm trying to hide it, you know, from the people in the audience there. But anyway, Judge Gertner, before you came, we were talking with our listeners earlier about their optimism or lack of optimism for 2023, and tons of people texted that they said they were hoping that 2023 would be the year that Donald Trump got indicted and was brought before the law. Adam Kissinger, one of the Republicans on the one of two Republicans January 6th committee, he said that earlier this week. He believes the evidence uncovered of President Trump's involvement in the attack on the Capitol justifies criminal charges. Here he is.
If a president can incite an insurrection and not be held accountable, then really there's no limit to what a president can do or can't do. And so, yeah, I do think ultimately when we get to where we're going to go, I think the Justice Department will do the right thing. I think he will be charged. And I frankly think he should be.
Is he right?
I don't think there's any question that he is. One of the things that the January 6th committee did is, you know, force the DOJ's hand. If this had been a confidential, quiet grand jury investigation, first of all, people wouldn't know the scope of it. And they could, and you know, Merrick Garland, is the attorney general, is a relatively cautious guy, and they could have delayed and delayed and delayed. I really think they forced their hand. They've complicated the job of the DOJ, though, because if exactly because most prosecutions are confidential, grand jury confidential, interviews confidential until the indictment, and then it becomes public. And part of the reason for that is that then it means that witnesses can't dovetail their testimony to what other people are saying. So clearly it complicated the DOJ's task now, because they have an enormous amount of material to look at, but also because people can say, well, he said that, oh yeah, maybe I do remember that, or maybe I don't remember that. It makes it harder to do. But I think they forced his hand.
But yeah, Judge Gertner, I believe that too, with obviously not the credentials you have. However, in the last few days, I've obsessed on the flip side of this. Reading about some unnamed prosecutors in the Department of Justice saying, let's take each of the things, the documents and the insurrection separately. On documents that, yes, technically he's in violation of law, but that it's not serious enough to indict a former president. It appears, I know that, I think you've told us that motive is not relevant. However, a number of them have concluded it was all about ego, not about selling documents to China. Or something, and then your buddy, who literally is your buddy, Hillary Clinton, the argument goes, she had some classified documents in her email. That's documents. On the insurrection, I read, well, he's just going to say his lawyers, who are real lawyers, even if they're incompetent lawyers, assured him that everything he was doing was perfectly legal. That's a defense. What do you say to both those
things? Well, first with Mar-a-Lago. Remember General Petraeus? Someone was writing a memoir, and he was sharing classified information with his lover, who was writing the memoir, and he gets prosecuted. So the nature of the classified documents don't have to be, you know, earth-shattering in order to prosecute. It's not just what he was clearly doing it for ego, at least that's what we think, but it's also the intentionality of it, the willfulness of it, from the White House all the way to just recently. That's more than just, I violated the law, whoops. That's, you know, thumbing your nose at the entire system. I really think that again, their hand is forced on that.
Okay, so on the insurrection, he says, I vetted every comment I made with my lawyers. Lawyers told me that everything I said was within the scope of permissible speech.
Well, people talk about, you know, his relationship to the insurrection as if it is only January 6th. What is interesting about what the committee did is they went all the way back to, you knew that you had lost, categorically knew that you had lost. Lawyers told you, everyone told you. And you essentially said, I'm going to keep on propagating the big lie. Then you knew even from Eastman that the false elector
scheme.
One of his lawyers, John Eastman. That the false elector scheme was baloney, and yet you pressed for it. What came out this morning, and it had been sort of buried in the pile of documents, was that he also had been talking about marching to the Capitol in advance. So the words, if it were only the words he spoke that day, sure, that would actually, not only would that be not indictable, or maybe not indictable, but it would also be troubling, right? You and I have been involved in advocacy movements where people on Boston Common, you know, would say things that they shouldn't, and you don't want them to be indicted for sedition. But it's more than just January 6th. Finally, I know you're about to interrupt.
No,
I can tell. I have no desire to let you jump
okay,
in here.
Okay, fine.
Judges around the country in dealing with the attorney-client privilege, you know, lawyers have testified before the January 6th committee and before the grand jury. So judges have found that it's called a crime fraud exception. Judges have found that even though lawyers were telling him X, he was using their advice to effect a fraud. So I don't think he can hide behind the lawyer's advice when the lawyer's advice was being used not to actually give you the truth, but for the purposes of enabling a false elector scheme, et cetera. Now you can talk.
I can't remember what I was going to say, but I was very satisfied with your response.
Well, I was interested in why Ginny Thomas, wife of Clarence Thomas, got short shrift in the January 6th investigation, and also whether you can believe her when she says, because Clarence Thomas has seemed to be very partial to the former president's legal efforts to have exceptions made for him, whether it's plausible that she didn't talk to Clarence Thomas, her supposed best friend, as she calls him, about her post-election efforts?
No.
You don't believe her? Yeah, I don't believe her. Why does she get... Because she...
They don't have any other evidence. I mean, she... They don't... So there are two things about it. One, because we've talked about this before. I am married to the legal director...
Well, yes.
The former legal director of the American Civil Liberties Union. And clearly, in every two, career, family, you talk about your work, et cetera. My husband, John Reinstein, could talk about his work, but I would not talk about mine. So... If Thomas didn't talk about the pending cases, then and she was just blathering about her political activities, that's what happens in a two-career family. However, knowing about her political activities, which he plainly did, he shouldn't be involved in any case
right.
involving January 6th, in any of the subpoena cases involving documents that were bound to include her text messages. So there's a difference between jammering on about your work over dinner your political activities, and presiding over cases where those activities are involved. That's a horse of a different color.
And other judges have accused themselves in those kind of situations, right?
And the thing, the difference between me and Clarence Thomas, one of the many 5,000 differences between me and Clarence Thomas, is that one of the problems with the Supreme Court is that there's no one to say to him, you must recuse yourself. If I didn't recuse myself, the First Circuit, the Court of Appeals, would have come down and said, you have to do it. So he should have, in case involving her text to Meadows, he should have in cases involving January 6th because she was there. And the standard is not just are you actually biased, the standard is the appearance of bias.
Well, that's the thing that I'm learning. I mean, I did not know about the Supreme Court charity that people who have lawyers who have corporate cases before the court, corporations, special interest groups, Chevron, you know, these different companies that are arguing before the Supreme Court get involved in this charity that the Supreme Court has that supposedly is going to teach people about the court's history and its importance in the American life. Tell us about this.
Well, the charity is actually a real thing.
It
right?
is a real thing.
It is a real thing. And there is, so let's start with the charity. It's certainly something of value, more than something of value, something valuable to talk about the institution and the background and the history, et cetera. What I didn't know, and I mean people, you know, I could send in a $100 check, which is a nice thing to do. It is troubling when corporations and when large donors are using it to get access to the court. That is troubling. Again, it's an appearance issue. But I think that that's a complicated question. It's complicated only in this respect. It's, again, appearance of impropriety. You give a lot of money, you get front seat in the Supreme Court. Clearly, that's true. It may be worse, but we don't know whether it's actual bias. We know it's the appearance of bias. And why not fund the Supreme Court Historical Society with public funds? Why not,
exactly.
why not do that? I mean, exactly to avoid this kind of issue. But it's like everything else in the Trump term. there wasn't an issue until it was excessive, right? There's a federal bar association. There are all sorts of bar associations, and judges interact with them. In fact, that's supposed to be the space which is appropriate for you to interact, less so maybe the ACLU or the American Constitution Society, but that seems to be appropriate. The problem here is that you used it for monumental contributions and access, and you were paying for access.
So you could have cocktails with them, and you could have dinner with them,
Well, again, I mean, it's the enormity of the contributions that are the issue here. It hasn't been an issue up until this point. It's the sustained campaign nature of it. I think, as I said, one answer is to say public fund it. The other answer is to limit the donations.
Yeah.
Limit who can donate and limit how much they can donate, mostly how much they can donate.
You know, I have to say, for people who say, I don't think I'm directing this criticism at you, but maybe I am, that, you know, the appearance of impropriety, human nature is, as we've said to you, we've spoken to Sheldon Whitehouse, Senator Whitehouse, a lot of times about his brilliant work on dark money in the Supreme Court and all that sort of thing. So while we don't know, for example, who spent millions of dollars on ads to get Coney Barrett on the Supreme Court, I'm assuming it's a fairly good bet Coney Barrett knows who spent millions of dollars to get her on the Supreme Court. Even the most honorable person I know, if you know somebody has done as big a thing for you as is possibly imaginable, it has to have some impact on your behavior, don't you think?
But you're really talking about sort of unwinding, dare I say it, capitalism.
Campaign financism, that's what I'm talking about.
It is true. It is true that you get into office, you become a judge, you have life tenure, and you no longer need those donors. It's not like a politician. You no longer need those donors. You could certainly say, I'm sorry, I'm going to make my decisions on my own. So I'm not persuaded. I mean, Ted Kennedy went out of his way to get me to become a judge. That doesn't mean if Kennedy ever appeared before me, I would tilt in his favor. I loved the man, but I understood the difference between advocacy and the job. I don't see how you can unwind that unless you had a full public funded campaign.
Well, so then based on, forget judges, when an elected leader says, oh, I'm not affected by the fact that I went to a fundraiser last night where everybody gave $10,000 to my campaign, failing to say, by the way, people who can't afford $10,000 don't get access to me, except on Boston Public Radio, by the way. I'm serious. The reality is access changes a relationship,
But there's a difference between an elected official and a judge. And putting aside elected judges, the elected
official...
Because
they have lifetime tenure.
That's right. The elected official, you got me here, and not only that, I'm going to need your support to stay here. And that creates a whole set of incentives. That's why campaign finance laws should be changed.
Well, a piece of you, we've had this discussion about 1,000 times, that you and Larry Tribe went onto the presidential commission supporting term limits for judges, justices, and you came out supporting expansion of the court for a variety of reasons, including the former may require a constitutional amendment. Let's assume there were term limits, which I favor, on justices. Then I assume you'd have, of course they can't serve a second term, so have a concern.
You wouldn't have. Okay. It's so interesting. As soon as you become a judge, you're sort of told to watch out who you're hanging out with, right? You don't want to go to advocacy events. I mean, I was allowed to...
Did you not?
No, I went to the ACLU because I was a wife. Uh-huh. I mean, I was a wife, so I was going to be there as a wife. That's a whole different issue. But, I mean, I wasn't going to... I mean, you had to be careful about that. People were concerned about that. People could move to disqualify you. There was no question about it. But it's... But the areas that you're supposed to go to, bar associations, federal bar, mass bar, Supreme Court Society... What's so interesting about this controversy is that was taken over by the same money that was, that is in political campaigns. That we've never seen before.
Yeah.
That was
supposed
to be a safe space for judges to hang out. Yes, there's a question of money for access, but at least that was not supposed to be a political space. And, I'm not sure what... I mean, one has to look at that critically, but I'm not sure that there's much one can do about it except change the funding structure.
Can I interrupt one second before we continue, what? Just to give people an update? The vote for House Speaker is going on, and as you know, Congressman McCarthy can only lose 4 votes, I believe, amongst his Republican colleagues and win the speakership on the first ballot. Already, Republican Congressman Biggs, who's one of the people who opposes him, has 7 votes. And while they're allowed to change their vote before the final vote is gaveled through, in all likelihood, I think for the first time, what is it, in 100 years, a man running for Speaker of the House will not be elected on the first ballot.
Interesting.
And we'll let you know about what happens after that. We're talking to former federal judge Nancy Gertner.
Just one last thing on this. I don't want to belabor this point, but it used to be back in my cub reporter days, and for quite a while cub after reporter. That, you weren't supposed to socialize at all with people that you covered. And one of the things that's been difficult for me when I was both a reporter and doing the radio is that you'd have politicians come on like Deval Patrick or like Charlie Baker, and you kind of liked them. And it made it harder for you to be tough on them. And I think that's one of the things that is human nature, that maybe judges should not socialize with people.
Well, yes and no. I mean, on the one hand, one of the things I've been writing about it, and when I write about my work, which I've been doing for some time, is that if you put judges in an ivory tower, they also have no idea what the community is that they serve.
Yeah, well, that's the point.
There's no question about that. You know, I mean, in the federal court, I could get up in the morning in Brookline, I would drive to the court, go under the city, come up through the building, and I wouldn't ever see the communities of Boston that I actually had known when I was a lawyer. So you have to figure out a way. I mean, it has to be sort of a rule of reason. It has to be being cautious about this. But if you take judges and put them in the Supreme Court and say you can't marry anyone who's involved in politics, you can't engage, you can't, well, they're going to be even more out of touch with everything.
Okay, well, that's a good rejoinder to that one. So let's talk about justice's safety. Chief Justice John Roberts is very concerned about this. This seems to be reaching a new level with people going after justices in their homes.
There's no question about it. I mean, what triggered the bill that was just passed was he was a friend of mine, a judge who was a district court judge, had a disgruntled litigant who appeared at her door because her address was easily accessible. Her son opened the door
That's horrible.
Shot her son.
Which
he was clearly going after her.
Horrible.
Shot her son and actually shot her husband. That had actually happened before to a judge in the Midwest. So, yes, that's a thing. There's no question about it.
And Justice Kavanaugh outside his home.
Right. So that's an important thing to do. There's no question about it. My only issue with what Justice Roberts was saying is that his end-of-the-year report said that, you know, talked about the judge who was one of the judges who had enforced Brown versus Board of Education and how he had to do that enforcement notwithstanding threats and how important judge security is. I just thought that was an ironic description to talk about Brown versus Board of Education on the cusp of Roberts undoing affirmative action.
That's a great point.
I mean, I have an op-ed coming out about this. I mean, it's like putting their security issues in the framework of the courageous judges who tried to eliminate race discrimination, and then suggesting we're all in the same box. Actually, not. Actually, not.
The guy that I thought was going to be the big savior of the Supreme Court has just gone so far down.
Well,
I
mean, Roberts you're talking about.
Roberts, yes.
I mean, to some degree, this was an end-of-the-year report that was intended to annoy no one, but actually was not going to say anything. So the end-of-the-year report, every year the Chief Justice issues a State of the Courts report. And in past years, they would talk about sexual harassment on the bench and talk about really substantive things. He was talking about what had happened in the 50s and security, avoiding leaks, ethics violations, conflicts of interest, and all the other, and the ways in which the court has distorted the shadow docket, the cases they hear without actually any arguments. He avoided all of that.
So why?
because he doesn't want to engage with the controversies, is what he wanted to avoid. He wanted to avoid the controversy. But even more than that, attached to his report, this is getting a little nerdy, so give
it's
me a
okay. No, be nerdy.
We're nerdy.
Because okay. We're not allowed to interrupt you, so we have no choice, you know what I mean?
No, we're nerdy.
Attached to the report is a appendix about the statistics of the federal court, and the caseload of the federal court has declined dramatically. Federal appeals court, even the Supreme Court. And why? One, I'm speculating, but academics say one reason is civil rights cases, any lawyer representing a civil rights plaintiff will go to the federal court only if they are willing to commit malpractice. So people are avoiding the federal courts in those kinds of cases. In addition, they're squeezing people to do arbitration, but mostly the civil rights cases, you basically avoid the federal courts because you know that even if you win in the district court, and even if you win as a plaintiff in the Court of Appeals, who knows what the Supreme Court will do? So all of a sudden, the docket has declined, and he doesn't talk about that. That's attached to his report, but he doesn't talk about that.
Now, I ask you this every time you come here, and you're probably sick of having me ask you this.
Do it again.
Again, his politics are different than mine, but I had great respect for Justice Roberts. You know, as a Supreme Court justice, did a lot of things I disagree with, but overall, and I kept hearing about how concerned he was about the legacy of the court and the esteem with which people held the court in the United States. So that's just a bunch of baloney. That's all gone out the window because he's in charge when the thing is dropping like the Hindenburg.
Well, I mean, I think he is an institutionalist. I think that he... If he was trying to, somewhat, what you understand, for example, in the abortion decision, he was trying to carve out not the elimination of all abortion, but a much more moderate position. I think that that's all true. I think he's not a zealot, but he has five rigidly conservative justices. He's no longer in control. He could well have gone up to Clarence Thomas and say, you know, I think you should recuse yourself from cases involving January 6th. Thomas says no.
Screw you, Chief
Justice.
That's
right. That's it. So I'm not sure that he has the kind of control that he even wanted. And I think this report reflects that. Why engage in issues over which he has no meaningful control? I'll talk about history and security.
Because he has the biggest bully pulpit.
Well, that's true.
Okay, before you go, when you were a federal judge, yes, you are.
Oh.
When you were a former federal judge, you're on the bench, and somebody rudely, like I attempted almost to do a minute ago, would interrupt you when you were speaking. How would you make clear to them that interruption was not appropriate in this particular courtroom?
Actually, because I was raised in a rambunctious Jewish family where around the table everyone interrupted everybody else, I oftentimes didn't know where my sentence ended and yours began. So my women law clerks would yell at me for not yelling at people for interrupting, but that was sort of, you're a different matter. You can't interrupt. But in my courtroom, I didn't think that mattered.
Judge Gertner, it's great to see you as always. Thanks so much,
Judge Nancy Gertner. Thank you very much. I'm sorry to obsess over Justice Roberts every time you come
Keep
in here, but maybe by
Marjorie.
Next time I'll get over it. Nancy Gertner is a retired federal judge. She's also a senior lecturer at Harvard Law School, and she's a BPR regular, and we're thrilled that she is. Coming up, the average American household wastes up to one-third of the food it buys. Central Ohio thinks they have a solution. We'll talk with food policy analyst Corby Kummer about how to combat food waste and about everybody's favorite, or maybe not everybody's, but the Cheesecake Factory. You're listening to Boston Public Radio, 89.7 GBH. We are broadcasting, streaming, I should say, on youtube.com/GBH News.
Thank you to all who donated during our recent membership campaign. Because of your contribution to GBH, we can continue to bring you the world news that is so vital at this time. And now, through our matching gifts program, you can double the impact of that donation. Visit gbh.org/matchinggifts to view the list of participating companies. If your employer participates, then your donation could go twice as far. That's gbh.org/matchinggifts.
Funding for our programs comes from you.
And Comcast Business, offering internet solutions with Comcast Business Internet for your small business. Includes Comcast Business Security Edge and internet speeds up to 10 gigs. Comcast Business, powering possibilities. Restrictions apply. Actual speeds vary. And Safety Insurance. Cyber coverage from Safety Insurance covers data restoration, data recreation, system restoration, and more. You can ask an independent agent about Safety Insurance. Safety Insurance. They'll help you manage life's storms, even the cyber kind.
Welcome back to Boston Public Radio. Jim Browdy, Marge Regan, live from the Boston Public Library. We'll be back on Friday as well, streaming at youtube.com/GBH News. They're still voting on the speaker job, and it appears, well, actually, there were five votes a couple of minutes ago.
Yeah, there were seven votes.
What for happened? His Republican opponent. It's now down to five, so maybe reports of his demise are premature.
So does that mean they voted and then they
switch? You can switch your vote while the voting is still
okay.
Open. Oh, it's back,
up,
back
to
seven.
Up to seven.
This is good radio. In any case, sorry I brought it up. We'll let you know as soon as the results are in. We're joined now on Zoom by Corby Commerce. Corby is the executive director of the Food and Society Policy Program at the Aspen Institute, a senior at the Atlantic, and a senior lecturer at the Tufts Friedman School of Nutrition, Science, and Policy. Hello, Corby Commerce.
Hello, Jim, and hello, Marjorie.
Well, hey there. There's no better time to talk about food waste than after the holidays, when many of us bought all this food for family that was coming, and of course, it all wasn't eaten. And what did most of us do? Throw it in the trash, where it goes into the landfill and becomes methane gas. Food waste is a huge problem, Corby. Tell us.
So it's a huge problem. It's up. It's between 35% and 40% of all the food that we drink and eat and buy, and it goes into landfills, and it's just miserable. So the New York Times recently did a story about a public school that is doing beautifully in teaching all of its residents and all of its students on how to take food home. It started when a fourth grader cried when she saw her mother put stuffed peppers, her favorite meal, into the trash. And the mother said, I have to do something about this. She went to the school. The school started an entire statewide program, and it's resulted in 30% less food waste in the school system in Upper Arlington, in, I'm going to be reminded of the state, which
Central Ohio.
Central Ohio,
which has been a pioneer, by the way, in many food systems changes, Central Ohio and the Columbus area. And so the idea is, if you teach students, and for example, you put the waste baskets right in the middle of the cafeteria, saying, here's what goes to compost, here's what goes to recycling, those students know every bit of food they're wasting, and it shows them that their cups and their napkins can be composted, exactly the food that can be composted, and all of the bottles and containers that can be recycled. And it's something, you know, teachers stand behind the bins and they help them out with, here's the decision about that, it's tricky, the napkins, they can be composted. But it all really works. And so the idea that schools can do something, and this is a public school system with a small, modest grant of, I think, $25,000, huge results.
You know, I don't mean to sound like a holier-than-thou jerk, but I started composting a few weeks ago in Brookline. Yes, and it is so easy and so satisfying because you realize you have a lot less garbage, and you don't feel so bad about throwing the food that you didn't eat out because it's going to be composted, and they come by and pick it up once a week with your trash in a container. You have to pay a few dollars extra to get it done, and you see it more and more. Households are doing the composting
thing. But we should be clear, the Ohio experiment, which is on a small scale that Corby's talking about, is not just teaching you to compost as opposed to other disposal. It's also doing a public awareness campaign about not only how much food waste there is and what the impact is on the climate, but how to avoid wasting food to begin with, so you don't have to compost it. And I have to say, Corby, I hate to give you a little credit here. I had no idea until you started talking to us about this a year or so ago that food waste was this huge percentage of the emissions problem in this society. And I have to say, I am, I think, a fairly good example of somebody. I'm surely not where I need to be, but the more I learned about ways to be more responsible without being totally discomforted, if that's the appropriate verb, the more I've done it. And so I think the centerpiece of what they've done in Ohio, which is great, is raise public awareness among people who want to do the right thing, but don't know how. Is that a fair statement?
Jim, you're almost there. So
I wouldn't go that far, but okay.
Marjorie is there. So, first of all, I'm incredibly skeptical of public awareness programs, and I've spent my life in journalism, so I should certainly believe in it. But the idea that this has had results, I find huge. What I think has more results is if a state like California or boroughs of New York City mandate composting and make it easy for Marjorie. They'll pass out liners and bins.
They do.
And they will have a weekly pickup. So yes, it might be yucky, but when you read about what this guy named, I think Kyle, in Central Ohio, his name is Kyle O'Keefe, he dived into people's bins to find out exactly what they were. He measured all of their food waste in Central Ohio before they implemented this action campaign. And so the idea, it's when California mandates it, it's when a city makes it possible and easy for you to do the kind of composting that Marjorie has so terrifically undergone. And that's when you're going to be there, Jim.
You know, I forgot, we should not skip the story you told, you touched on in the story in the New York Times. They talk about this guy who selected 200 homes. He went and picked up their garbage with their permission before the changes, would dump it out on a table, maggots and all, it says in the New York Times, and sort through to see how much food's in there. And then the results, there was a lot less waste after. Let me tell one other program, by the way. I don't know if we did this on the radio or I only did this on TV. Did we talk about the Too Good to Go program on the radio?
Oh, yes. Hotels and places.
Hotels and restaurants, including the Oak Bar right around the corner.
Yep.
Sometimes for breakfast, sometimes at the end of the day, you go on their website. And for roughly a third of the price of a meal, or at least portions of a meal, had you eaten in the restaurant or the hotel or that sort of thing, wonderful things are available. Not only you might not have been able to afford, but equally importantly, they would have gone to waste otherwise. So a lot of little things being done.
Coming in to buy these really great meals cooked at the
Too Good to Go. It's
called Copley Plaza Hotel, which is a gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous hotel.
We're talking to Corby Cummer.
So because a lot of us stayed home during the pandemic and ordered DoorDash and all those other food delivery systems, things have really changed in terms of climate change and traffic congestion for restaurants?
So there are new studies about this. First of all, a number of things in this Boston.com report stunned me. The thing that most stunned me is that before the pandemic, residents of Boston averaged more than $500 a year on restaurant deliveries before the pandemic. Yeah. And what the piece says is that deliveries post-pandemic have doubled in Boston and across the country. So what does this mean? It means double parking. It means more energy emissions while food door dashers wait and idle their engines in front of a restaurant. So double parking in traffic, and then in Manhattan, everyone's on an electrified bike now. And so it's great that Manhattan and Boston and Cambridge have enacted all of these bicycle lanes, but that becomes more of a hazard for anybody walking when everybody's zooming by on an electronic bicycle. They're mostly delivery people. It also reduces jobs for service workers, a lot of them, reduces street traffic when ghost kitchens, which make takeout meals, take over a lot of the business of deliveries. But just these raw facts of doubled deliveries since the beginning of the pandemic and the amount that Bostonians are spending on these are kind of what knocked me back when I read this.
You know, but one of the things that was not mentioned in the story, I know it wasn't the focus, so it's not a criticism of the writer, is while they talk about the climate impacts of the doubling of these, using these third-party apps and other things to have your food delivered, they're not talking about what you and we talked about a ton during the pandemic, how these services totally screw the restaurants that they're serving. The good news is the restaurant is able to get food to somebody who wouldn't come in. The bad news is they're essentially taking all their profits with usurious kinds of fees, no?
Yes, and let me remind you, as I shouldn't have needed to be reminded, and thank you, Jim, that California tried to sue DoorDash and Uber Eats saying you are taking 30% of the revenues of the restaurants for your entire service, and they did actually cap it at 15%, unlike any other state in the country, but they got sued, and it was rolled back, actually, I think, by a state ballot initiative, that idea of capping these rates at 15%. Why is that so completely damaging to restaurants? Because the services won't allow the restaurants to inflate their menu prices for the menus that go on to DoorDash and Uber Eats and Grubhub. They say you've got to post the same restaurant prices that you charge inside your restaurant. It's a really rotten deal for restaurants, but given their incredible losses during the pandemic, they had to swallow and take it. And why that hasn't changed, I still don't know, and thanks for reminding us.
Well, you know, but let me, by the way, Zoe, our colleague, just reminded us, Massachusetts, too, capped delivery fees. Was it 15%? I can't remember.
I think so.
While the emergency 15. Order from Baker was in place, and obviously when he lifted that, it disappeared. You know, the thing I don't understand about your inability to inflate prices so that you don't lose all your profit, Instacart, I mean, I'm a big, as you know, market basket person in Somerville, but I know for a fact that the price I pay in the store for, let's say, seltzer is lower than the price I pay when during the pandemic I was ordering seltzer through Instacart. So what are they, just violating the law, or what's going on?
Yeah, but I don't get it. Are you saying Market Basket was on Instacart?
Yeah, yeah.
Because it has to be the same vendor that you're talking about.
It is the same vendor,
A vendor can decide that they'll offer seltzer to Jim Browdy as a loss leader because he orders so much that it's worth it because you'll order other stuff. But I don't know. I would think that it really would vary vendor to vendor.
Okay. We're talking to Corby Cummer.
So there was also a story, I'm not sure where this is from, actually, but it's talking about how people have changed their habits in terms of dining out, and that there, we all know there are fewer people in restaurants, there are many more people doing drive-throughs, and they talked about this Taco Bell that has four drive-through lanes. And
it was Laura Riley in a terrific Washington Post.
Was it Washington Post? I'm sorry.
Yeah. About how the pandemic has altered the restaurant business. Drive-through is up 13%. And chain after chain is instituting more drive-throughs. McDonald's is pioneering a no-seats restaurant. And I think, what is it, Taco Bell is already...
And a no-beef hamburger, too, by the way. And I don't mean Beyond Meat, but go ahead.
That's good.
Thank you very much. I appreciate
that. Thank
you. But
the idea of these drive-through-only locations, it's the same thing as ghost kitchens and delivery. If people only want to be going up and doing contactless, no seats, that's one thing. I think it's bad for communities. I think it's bad for removing places for people to gather. And as we've talked about, McDonald's is one of the first places that would go into underserved neighborhoods and democratize restaurant dining and desegregate. So it was surprisingly beneficial community activity in a restaurant like McDonald's. But now the idea that it's delivery only, it's what people want, and restaurants are starting to open it. For so far, it's only a pilot for Taco Bell.
Yeah.
For McDonald's, Taco Bell, I think, has instituted some of them, but more and more of these are going to open.
Well, listen to the description of this Taco Bell place. It's in this Minneapolis suburb. It talks about, I've mentioned, the four drive-through lanes, kitchen on the second floor. But the lanes are devoted solely to delivery drivers or orders placed on the Taco Bell app, and the food is delivered downward via space-age-looking tubes to customers' cars in about 2 minutes from the time they ordered. I mean...
And by the way, you keep reading. You just put your head back and it puts it right in your mouth. It's like, you don't have to do anything. You know,
I mean, it really
is. Can I do a quiz with you, too?
Weird.
You may not remember this, but here's a good quiz. It just occurred to me.
Yeah.
We had this discussion years ago. I don't know if it was with you. What did the man in California who opened the first drive-through restaurant in America do with that drive-through lane several years ago, and why? You're the food guy. Don't give it away.
Okay.
Corby, do you know the answer to the question?
I've lost this.
Okay.
He shut it down.
Why did he shut it down?
Because he thought people were gaining too much weight.
I can't believe you remember this, because the obesity crisis.
Yeah, everybody had to get out of their car and walk into the store to buy food.
I love that. In any case.
So,
speaking of the obesity crisis, let's end on Cheesecake Factory.
Yeah. Vox.com has got this incredible place. Everything you wanted to know about. It goes on like for thousands of words. But it's this unbelievably positive review of a place where I haven't necessarily been fond of going, but I guess I'm wrong. The Cheesecake Factory.
Can I remind you that one of the smartest human beings who happens to live in the Boston area, Atul Gawande, wrote a whole piece in the New Yorker comparing their kind of automated, incredibly efficient consumer research and then implementation of menus could offer healthcare facilities a new way to be more customer responsive and efficient in their use of staff. So,
Wait, what was his point?
I'm going to have to look it up.
Wait, was his point that you need an EMT if you eat at the Cheesecake Factory? Is that his point? What was his point?
You are leaping to that.
What was his point?
The idea is that they had hundreds of items on a menu.
Hundreds.
And that with variations, they could train a staff to perform and execute those many, many operations. And in this Vox.com piece, we were reading that there are 2-page thick manuals just for the saute station, and there are many stations at a restaurant. This is this slavishly worshipful recounting of how gorgeous and luxurious and special occasion and celebratory and fabulous the Cheesecake Factory is, with its many hundreds of menu items that somehow are all made fresh on premises. The only thing that isn't is, ironically, the cheesecake.
That's pretty funny.
But, you know, all of the rest, and I kept thinking, boy, do I hope Vox.com has fact checkers, because this sounds so much like company propaganda.
It does.
But, Corby,
does.
One question for you, because we're a little short on time here. The basic thesis, other than fawning over the Cheesecake Factory in 10,000 words, was to say that the Cheesecake Factory runs counter to every rule of restaurants, particularly in a pandemic world. They have 250 items on their menu. It's a 20-page menu. Most restaurants are limiting the number of items, that minimizing everything, staff, number of items that are made fresh in your restaurant is the direction. So in a sentence or two, why is the Cheesecake Factory, why have they prospered when they're running counter to the conventional wisdom as to how restaurants in general prosper, Corby Comer?
I think that it has to be high volume and high quality. The idea that they can employ as many staff as they do still kind of really mystifies me, but I want to plug a new documentary called Automat. And what everybody remembers about the Automats, including a New Yorker I saw just last week, is the high quality of the food. Cheesecake Factory has made itself that reputation. People associate it not only with celebrations, but with high quality food.
They do.
You know, you mentioned, let me just say this for a second. The Automat, for those who don't know what Automat is, the film, I had the director on, Lisa Hurwitz, a few weeks ago on TV. The film, which basically stars Mel Brooks, and Colin Powell, and all these people who grew up in Automats, it's basically about Horn and Hardart's, which were in Philadelphia and New York. I grew up in Philadelphia, moved to New York. And there are these things where all the homemade food was behind a little glass door. You'd put a nickel, a quarter, three quarters into a little slot, and the glass door would pop open and you'd take this item out. And this woman, a young woman, does this brilliant film about how the Automat was a great sort of equalizer in many communities too.
And democratized, you spent a fortune on decor like the Cheesecake Factory, so it gave you the illusion of grandeur, and it was cheap and high quality. And Cheesecake Factory has made affordable food and very high quality.
Our show is cheap and high quality, same kind of thing.
Exactly.
Hey, Corby, it's great to see you. Thank you, Corby Comer.
Thank you very much, Corby Comer. We've been speaking with Corby Comer. Corby Comer is Executive Director of the Food and Society Policy Program at the Aspen Institute, a Senior Editor at the Atlantic, and a Senior Lecturer at the Tufts Friedman School of Nutrition, Science, and Policy. Thank you so much, Corby Comer. Coming up, we're going to talk about the Cheesecake Factory with you. Why is the Cheesecake Factory so big? Just not in numbers of items available. And not just as a chain with more than 200 locations in the United States. We mean big as in cultural importance. Apparently, Jim, people go there for birthdays. They go there for anniversaries. Very romantic. They go there for proms. And it supposedly captures millennial nostalgia, Jim, for when those millennials were young and carefree, and they want to go back and capture a little bit of that vibe. What do you think about the Cheesecake Factory? You can call or text us, 877-301-8970, 877-301-8970.
It's a new class of Congress. The members of the 118th make their debut this week, and we're asking what's in store for them and for us. And hey, what are you looking for out of this new Congress? Call us at 877-869-8253. I'm Melissa Harris-Perry, and that's next time on The Takeaway from WNYC and PRX.
This afternoon at 2, here on GBH News 89.7.
Our programs are made possible thanks to you. And The Huntington. From acclaimed Boston playwright Kate Snodgrass and director Amelia Bensusan comes the new play, The Art of Burning. Starts January 13th at the Huntington's Calderwood Pavilion, BCA. Tickets at huntingtontheater.org. And Legal Seafoods, helping you celebrate the holiday season with seafood. You can give the gift of fresh fish with Legal Seafoods gift cards, available at their restaurant locations or online at legalseafoods.com/giftcards.
Welcome back to Boston Public Radio. Jim Browdy, Marge Regan, live at the library, streaming at youtube.com/GBH News. We'll be back here on Friday. We talked about, with Corby Comer, about the Cheesecake Factory. And we want to know, are you a Cheesecake Factory disciple? What about it appeals to you? The world's biggest menu, its unapologetic, unpretentious presentation. Why do you think it's been elevated beyond chain restaurants, apparently, to cultural icon? And if you don't love it, but frankly hate it, we'd like to know why. 877-301-8970 is our number. You ever been to a Cheesecake Factory in your life?
Yes, I have. It's one in the Chestnut Hill, and I've been there before.
What do you think?
I don't remember. It was such a long time ago. But you know something? They have 31 different kinds of cheesecakes.
They do?
At the Cheesecake Factory. Yes. They have a 20-page menu. They have like 8 different kinds of martinis. Maybe I should go and check that out.
You should.
8 different kinds of martinis. They have pages after page of small plates and snacks.
There's no such thing as a small plate at the Cheesecake Factory.
Well, they have the arugula salad, Jim. Maybe it's enormous. I don't know, but they go on and on. They have whole pages just with steaks and chop varieties.
You know, last time, let me tell you something. I don't know about all the portions. I was there, last time pre-pandemic, the one at, what's the name of the joint? At Cambridge Side Galleria. I think that's where it was. And I ordered a Caesar salad. And I would say, and I'm a fairly big eater, I know it's shocking, what was left over could feed the people of Revere. I mean, it is one of the primary reasons I would argue we have an obesity crisis in this country, because it is so popular and the portions are absolutely huge. But we want to know what your experiences are at the Cheesecake Factory. If you haven't read this piece in Vox.com, it is an ode.
It looks like it's
almost like a PR.
Like written by a PR
exactly.
thing.
It is really.
You know what their favorite, the most popular dish on the menu?
No.
Fettuccine Alfredo, ordered over 200,000 times per month. And you know what the second favorite is?
No.
Avocado egg rolls, Jim. Yeah. Where do you get that?
What I think is, for an extra $10, you can bathe in the Alfredo sauce.
You know what's third?
In the back room.
It's not just macaroni and cheese.
Oh, fried macaroni and cheese bowl.
Macaroni.
By the way, it's really good for you. It's only got 9,000 calories too, so it's actually a great
thing. That's right. You may have a heart attack while you're eating at the Cheesecake Factory, but in any case, people love it. We want to hear about your experiences at the Cheesecake Factory. Why do you love it? Did you go there for your 25th wedding anniversary?
Do you believe they make all the food except for baked goods?
They make all the food there.
On
That's
the
one of
premises.
The reasons the food is good. I mean, they gave it a good review for the food.
By the way, Kevin McCarthy is seconds away from being defeated on the first ballot of Speaker of the House. We'll let you know what next steps are. Emily and Hingham, you're first on Boston Public Radio. Hi, Emily.
Hi, Jim. Hi, Marjorie. Love your show. Thanks.
Thanks
for taking my call.
Thank you.
So my husband and I braved the Cheesecake Factory the week before Christmas with our 2 little kids.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the food was fine. The portions are enormous. But my problem with them is that they put mirrors on the back of the booth. So you have to watch yourself ingest these enormous portions. So it really makes you rethink your menu choice when you
Why
have to
would
watch
they do
yourself
that?
Shove fried egg roll in your face.
By the way, it would seem to me it runs exactly counter to what they're trying to do.
Exactly.
Well, that
who
is
wants, a who wants to look in the mirror anytime, and especially when you're eating, you know, a huge portion with 2 little kids.
Yeah.
At you,
so did the family love it, though? Do they want to go back to the Cheesecake Factory?
Of course. I mean, the kids loved it. It's huge. It's fun inside. You know, the kids' meal, the kids' grilled cheese was enough to feed, you know, 30 football teams. But, you know,
that's what I take away from the joint. Boy, the mirror thing is huge. Emily, we're really glad you called. Thanks so much. Can you imagine looking at yourself while you're stuffing your pie hole?
No, I would not like to look at myself.
At the Cheesecake Factory?
Listen to the names of these cheesecakes. They've got the chocolate raspberry truffle cheesecake, the Kahlua cocoa coffee cheesecake.
Do you even like cheesecake?
I love cheesecake.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Snickers bar, chunks, cheesecake, brownie, sundae cheesecake. I mean, unbelievable. I think I have to go there tonight.
I think you should. Elizabeth in Cape Ann, you're on Boston Public Radio. What's up?
Oh, well, I used to go there. I love the salad, and I'd have a piece of cake and coffee sometimes on the way home. But it is so noisy. It's huge, and it's very high ceiling, no baffles, and it's just, I can't stand it. It just makes me want to run, so I leave. I'm waiting for them to put baffles and a sound barrier between me and the crowd.
Elizabeth, did you have the mirror experience at the prior caller?
No, I go to one that's up in, North Shore Mall off of 128 around Beverly on the way to Cape Ann.
Well, but, it's mirror free, that particular one. Okay, fair deal. Elizabeth, thank you very much for the call. Why do you have that look on your face?
I'm reading the text. This is from John at Oxford. I've never had a good meal or even a mediocre meal at the Cheesecake Factory. Tasteless, undercooked, overcooked crap. Not the best cheesecake either. On the other hand, we have this from another texter who says, all I have to say about the Cheesecake Factory is try the herb-crusted chicken with mashed potatoes and green beans. You will be impressed. It tastes amazing. And I wasn't a fan of the place until now.
You know, just occurred to me. Under Obamacare, don't they have to put calories on the menu? Could you look on the menu and tell us, Jamie, what the
there's no calories on this menu.
I know. The fettuccine alfredo, which is the most popular dish. How many calories in that baby? Let's go to Helen in Falmouth. Helen, welcome.
Hi, Jim and Marjorie.
Hey.
Thanks for taking my call.
Pleasure.
So the only Cheesecake Factory that I believe I ever went to was the one in Marina Del Rey in California, just south of L.A.
Yeah.
And my son and his family and I, we used to meet up with my brother-in-law and his family.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just such a celebratory place. It was clean. It was beautiful. The food was delicious. And it was right on the beach at Marina Del Rey.
My God.
And you could walk outside and walk, you know, and go down and visit the water. And they had this little playground there where you could, you know, the kids would swing on the swings. And it was just a great experience. I loved it.
What a tribute, Helen. That's beautiful. Thank you for the call.
Well,
by the way, we have the information on the calorie count.
Yeah.
Without chicken, the fettuccine alfredo is a mere 2,000 calories.
No problem.
Isn't that what you're supposed to eat the whole day? I think it is 2,000 is what you're supposed to do.
But they go on and on about the decor on this Fox piece. They say, who would expect you could walk from your local mall right into a place where Egyptian columns flank Greco-Roman accents, where mosaics, buttress glass fixtures that look like the Eye of Sauron, whatever that is, soaring ceilings.
What is it, actually?
Interior palm trees, faux wicker chairs. The factory
nothing
is
like
made,
faux wicker. That's my motto.
Is a place of chaotic phasmagoria, Jim.
Wow.
Phantasmagoria.
I don't
know how to
pronounce
that. Phantasmagoria
on the air.
Phantasmagoria.
Really?
Yes. It's meant to evoke wealth and extravagance.
Wow. Then we should be there. Let's go to Rhode Island where Victor is on whatever you're on. You're on the phone there. Hi, Victor. What's up?
Long time, first time.
Yeah.
Jim, you've been in New York and had New York cheesecake.
I lived in New York 15 years. I would have a slice of Junior's cheesecake, I would say, once a month at least.
I cannot stand Cheesecake Factory compared to New York Cheesecake Factory.
Those fighting words. Why is that, Victor?
Well, the one time I went to Cheesecake Factory, it was just this, like, fluffy thing, whereas New York cheesecake is a very dense, you can hardly eat a whole slice.
You can hardly pick up a Junior's cheesecake. That is totally correct. They are dense, and they are really heavy. Victor, thank you for reminding us of that. By the way, Eye of Sauron or whatever is from Lord of the Rings, our colleagues tell us.
Okay, thank you.
By the way, there's one other thing. A bunch of listeners have asked for this. Speaking of food, we have to share this with people. A couple of listeners texted earlier in the show when I mentioned the Christmas gift you gave me, which was
13
hard salamis.
That's correct.
And they asked for the soundbite, and apparently our producers promised we'd play it. So here's what I said, and I don't even know why I said it, but here's what I said in the first few minutes of the show today. Uh-huh. Between hard and soft salami. I checked that out too. 6 weeks in the fridge. You ready for this? Many months in the refrigerator. I guess the point was I wasn't supposed to mention hard and soft salami. It obviously had an impact on some people. My apologies. Debbie in Gloucester, you are next on Boston Public Radio. We're talking about the Cheesecake Factory here on Boston Public Radio. Welcome, Debbie.
Good afternoon. I'm not sure I want to follow your salami comment.
I know it's hard to follow
salami. No one
does. Yeah. Is that a salami in your pocket or whatever? Thank you. I'm sorry. What's up, Debbie?
Back when our children were in high school, we used to occasionally host a foreign exchange student.
Oh.
And as part of the American experience, we would always take them to the Cheesecake Factory.
Oh, how nice.
And the kids from Spain or France, wherever, were stunned and would photograph their meals. They had never seen that much food on a plate. Yeah.
Well, you know, Debbie, we were just talking to Corby Cummer. I didn't even think of this till just now about food waste. And I don't know this for a fact, but would you not assume that food waste is a real serious problem? I mean, I can really put it away. I don't think I've ever finished a meal at the Cheesecake Factory. Is that not an issue?
Well, I would hope you would take it home for lunch the next day. Yeah.
Exactly.
There was a
doggy
lady
bags.
Who called in earlier with a family with two small kids, and I was thinking, gosh, one order for the family of four.
That's a very fine point. I hope they're still listening. Debbie, thank you for the call. We appreciate it.
Lori from Rhode Island says she loves pairing the key lime martini with the key lime cheesecake, and she just says, at the factory.
Well, that's good. The factory?
Doesn't even say cheesecake.
I guess if you're a regular, you just call
exactly.
it the factory.
And somebody else points out they have a Skinnylicious menu there somewhere. I can't
I
find
doubt
it.
That. But I really find
yeah,
that
it's
hard
for people
believe.
That are trying not to eat too many.
Do you find... Page 92, Aiden just said. Do you find the number of items on the menu, apparently 250, I'm told. It looks like more to me.
Yeah.
Do you find that daunting
I do.
Or inviting?
I find it daunting. I mean, they've got 8 different kinds of hamburgers. You know, you can't decide what kind of hamburger to get. You want the old-fashioned hamburger, the factory burger, the Kobe burger, the double barbecue bacon cheeseburger. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. Page after page of pasta and specialties. They've got all these specialties. I'd be like in a half an hour just trying to figure out what to eat.
Now, by the way, you know what you should eat? I hate to make a recommendation like this because I haven't been there in years.
Yep.
But I would recommend, Jamie just shared this with me, the factory, as in the Cheesecake Factory, nachos with spicy chicken. Because they are a mere 2,950 calories. So I guess the notion is you can eat and then not have to eat the next day.
I guess that's it.
And be perfectly fine.
Dina from Westford, thank
2,950
you. 2,950
calories.
That's a lot. How many calories are you supposed to have in a day?
I think you're supposed to have like 2,000 or 2,200,
okay.
I think.
I guess you're over
like
your limit with that one dish.
Sorry, Dina. Go ahead.
Hi, Dina. Thank you for calling.
Hi. I have never been to the Cheesecake Factory.
Oh, that's
but
so sad.
It sounds like...
Yeah.
If you had some really good self-control, you could, you know, order something and bring it home and eat for days.
That's right. That's the idea.
And if you bring your own plasticware to bring it home in, then you're being even more ecologically
Wow, that's a beautiful
sound.
Thought. Yeah, but you know what the problem is, Dina, is there are many people in this country, I am the prime example, who, like dogs, do not have appetite control. So in the abstract, I'm serious, in the abstract, your idea is brilliant, but it is really hard for me not to finish what's sitting right in front of me. Do you have that skill?
Self-control, Jim. Self-control.
Well,
that's right.
Trying,
yeah.
Whatever.
Listen
Thank
to
you
this,
for your
from
call, Dina.
Ashley
it.
In West Roxbury, she worked at the Cheesecake Factory, and she said you have to try every menu item during training. It's just 5 days of eating, and you get
What are you
paid.
Supposed to have? 50? What does that mean? 50 items
well,
a day?
Well, it's 250 items. I don't know. I guess you spend the whole day. It has the whole thing.
Oh, like
and Dan from Randolph says, my wife had her Christmas plane flight to see her daughter canceled, wanted to go to the Cheesecake Factory to feel better. The wait was 1.5 hours on Thursday. Mm. Had to leave.
You know what
wow.
they've done, which is pretty creative because the company sounds very creative. The two most recent branches that they've opened in emergency rooms. So there's actually a very
well,
short
funny you should
distance
say that,
of travel.
Because Paul from Worcester says the amount That's of sodium it. In most of their items is so high they should be giving out rib spreaders and defibrillators. with each meal.
That's pretty good. We're
so
done.
So there you go. I don't know. Should I go to the Cheesecake Factory tonight? Should I get some takeout cheesecake?
Can I, in a moment of seriousness, yep. while there's the portions are ridiculous, mm-hmm. I've actually, the food is not, I mean, it's not like haute cuisine. It's really pretty good, actually.
Well, that's what they say. You get a lot of food and a high quality, a bit of food for the money. So there you go.
By the way, McCarthy, just to leave you, well, I assume the news will have us in a few minutes, apparently has lost on the first ballot. He actually got fewer votes than the Democrat, Hakeem Jeffries, who's not going to be the next speaker. So as to what happens next, I don't know, but history was made on the floor of the House today.
Okay, we are done.
We're done.
Yeah, we are done. But thank you very much for listening to another edition of Boston Public Radio. You can keep up with us 24/7 by way of our podcast, which is called, Boston Public Radio. Tomorrow, we're going to be speaking with Representative Ayanna Pressley.
Great.
I assume she's there.
I assume she is.
Voting today. Get the whole mood from her. Boston Globe columnist Marcella Garcia, outgoing Massachusetts State Senator Sonia Chang Diaz, GBH Executive Arts Editor Jared Bowen, and our animal expert and naturalist who's always uplifting, Simon Montgomery. I want to thank our crew, Zoe Matthews, Aidan Conley, Mackenzie Farkas, additional support provided by Brendan Deedy. Our engineer is John the Claw Parker, with Bill Piacitelli on the board for us today. Our executive producer is Jamie Bologna. Special thanks to the team at the BPL, Brad Lewis, Evelyn Brito, and Colin Cockrell.
Do you want to thank people for coming?
I do. I want
thank you all for coming. We really appreciate it.
Down to the Boston Public Library. Really appreciate that, especially on this crummy day. I am Marjorie Egan.
I am Jim Browdy.
Thanks again for tuning in. Hope you can tune in tomorrow. And meanwhile, keep dry and enjoy the afternoon.
Bye.